pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Under the Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to the Texas one and indivisible.
Do we have a pastor here who supports prayer?
We bow our heads, please. Dear Lord, as we join in this day, we give thanks for the wonderful blessings that we receive. We ask for our city, we ask for the people of this wonderful community, and we ask for continued blessings for everybody and their families, and for the business that's about to partake here tonight. And Lord, we ask for your guidance, and as we partake on this very important issue that deals with our country and that deals with our border, and that the right decisions, that you might enlighten the right people that are these decisions to be made, so that our people will not be made to suffer. In this we pray. Amen.
Sister Claire, would you please read the call? Be seated, please.
Notice of public meeting of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville. Pursuant to Chapter 551, Title 5 of the Texas Government Code, the Texas Open Meetings Act, notice is hereby given that the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, in accordance with Article 5, Section 12 of the Charter of said city, will convene a workshop and regular meeting with an executive session on Tuesday, October the 2nd, 2007 at 5 p.m. and 6 p.m. in the Commission Chambers on the second floor of the Brownsville City Hall Federal Building, located at 1001 East Elizabeth Street, Brownsville, Cameron County, Texas. Workshop Item A, Discussion Regarding Phase 3 of the Brownsville Urban Systems Multimodal Project.
And City Commissioners, the purpose of this workshop is to give you an update on where we are and the status of the terminal itself, and also recap on where we are with the acquisition and negotiation of the property on that terminal. On the City Commission meeting of May 1st, staff recommended that the commencement of the last two phases of the multimodal terminal project commence, and during phase three, that's when the final design and construction document preparations will be accomplished. On July 19th and 20th, 2007, Carter and Burgess conducted the kickoff meeting for phase three and also had an intercity bus provider workshop. During this process, design modifications to the facility program requirements were identified. Carter and Burgess will be presenting the proposed changes to the terminal facility and the impact it will have on the project as they move forward to the final design. Just to recap, this is the preferred site. This is the location where the project will take place, and I'm sure you're familiar with this. This is and it's bordered. This is the property that we will be acquiring. It's between 13th Street International, Adams, and Jefferson. And to date, we have, next slide, please. To date, we have acquired 10 properties. We're in the process of in property negotiations with one, and two properties are in condemnation proceedings. At this time, I'm going to turn the presentation over to Alan Zurich, who's the representative of Carter and Burgess, who will go over the design of the facility.
Good afternoon. I'm just going to briefly give you a little history on the project and then go into the modifications that we've been made, that have been made based on the meetings we had with the transportation providers earlier this summer. This is the initial site layout. It consisted of the Brownsville Urban Systems bus operations and boarding area along Jefferson, a parking area along Adams and 13th, the main terminal building which served the inner city bus operators, which had about 10 bus bays located along what initially was 15th Street. At this location. Further orient you, Adams is along the bottom, Jefferson's along the top, International Boulevard. This was the original concept design that we had started with was evolved and completed and approved about a year ago. This is looking up 14th Street with Adams in the foreground. This is a view from essentially Adams and 13th, looking at the entry to the facility, the bus operations area, and the public plaza in front of the building. Essentially, the timeline that we've been working with, we completed that original design, just a conceptual design, still to be evolving, though, throughout the process. in August of 2006. In July of this year, we began what we call program validation, where we went back to the transportation providers and to the bus operations, people that had been involved in the project since it had been essentially on the shelf for about a year, or really 2 years since we started the project, to reevaluate the program, bring the providers back in, and get their input one more time. What we found out through that process was that the interest had grown around the facility, which is a good thing, but it had some major modifications that would be required to accommodate the additional program requirements of additional transportation providers that showed interest. As part of that, we had to look at the site a little differently, determined it would require some traffic modifications, street alignment, and changing Adams from one-way street to a two-way street. We met with the city traffic engineer, developed a traffic analysis, developed a preferred alternative, which we'll be showing to you here shortly. Essentially what changed in the project program, the original program required about 9 to 10 inner-city bus bays with the transportation providers that are shown here. When we met with them again this year, we had two additional providers, Sultana and Tudemex, that showed up having an interest in the facility, both wanting bus bays, both wanting counter space, office space, and so forth within the facility. So our new requirement, it grew from 9 to 10 inner-city bays to 16 to 18 inner-city bus bays, which is a fairly significant change in terms of the operation of the facility. So the rest of what I'm going to show you is the modification that we've been working with to make the adjustments to accommodate the new program. If you remember, initially the inner city buses were over here, kind of at the extension of 15th Street in this area. What we've had to do to accommodate this many more buses, about 30% more buses on the site, is to leave the local bus bays up here along Jefferson, essentially where they operate the best, because they have bus routes on 13th and on Jefferson that flow in and out of the facility. But then to put the inner city bus bays into their parking positions along Adams, where the buses flow into the site and back out along Adams, moving the terminal down to the intersection of Adams and International, which actually, when we go back to the design advisory committee on this, who we've been working with, they're going to be very excited about this, because one of the concerns about the initial design was that it was somewhat removed from International, kind of turned its back on International, and now we're putting the front door of the facility on International. Look at that a little closer. This is just blowing up the view a little bit. This is the primary terminal facility, which would be ticketing, passenger waiting. One advantage of this concept is it left us the ability to put retail fronting on International. So this little block you're seeing here is about 12,000 square feet of retail space, which we previously couldn't accommodate. And now we're actually putting that retail frontage, kind of the highest and best use for retail, along International Boulevard, with an entry plaza, public plaza here, possibly a tower to the building to signify its entrance. And you can essentially be able to see this building as soon as you cross the International Gateway Bridge. So moving it down to the corner had some urban design, some planning, and some architectural advantages over the previous design. But what did have to be accommodated is a long canopy here that now provides access out of the terminal building down to the bus parking positions. From the circulation standpoint, as you're aware now, Adams is one way through this area, eastbound, intersecting International. In order to get the International bus bays or inner city bus bays to work in this location, we're having to put in a single lane reverse flow through movement, essentially making Adams two-way from International to 13th. So traffic on International would come down, enter the bus bays, access taxi and drop-off lanes along here, and then turn right on 13th. So we'll be leaving 13th one-way, northbound. The two lanes that are currently on Adams, one will be a through lane, the other one will be required to turn north on 13th, and then the now westbound lane on Adams will be required to turn.
Can I ask a question real quick?
Yes, sir.
About retail spaces.
Yes.
Is that going to be leased? The city's going to lease out those spaces?
That'll be part of a financial plan that evolves as part of the project, but yeah, that would be owned by the city. It's potential for a public-private partnership to bring a developer in to work with you on building that, but it essentially would be income-producing for the city, if the city desires to do that. If not, you could turn it over to a private operator to operate that and lease it.
There's no garage parking?
No garage parking. I'm glad you brought that up, though. There's a current city parking lot of about 78 spaces located immediately south of Adams. It's a fairly new lot. The thought is that would be used for visitor parking and employee parking for the facility. And then we're trying also to get as much curbside drop-off space along the facility as well. This lot, which is owned by the city, could be converted in the future to structured parking with lower-level retail. So it might be a future phase of the project if it's needed. But those 78 spaces pretty much serve the current needs of the facility anyway in terms of the current program.
Parking could be public for people who want to cross the bridge, leave the cars there. And,
Do we have enough space?
Don't really have enough space for that because we're showing that, that much parking really needed for the facility itself.
Because that would be a good revenue.
Could be. Well, I mean, and you, I think if you rolled that, that use in with the need for 70, 80 spaces for the facility as well, that might justify building a parking structure here that could be income producing.
It can be two-level?
Retail.
Yeah, that's what you're saying, it can be multi-level.
Can be multi.
Years ago, we were making over 100.
The site is large enough, you might have to acquire the gas station on the corner to, for access, but the site would be large enough to accommodate multi-level parking structure. We had looked at that early on in the project, but determined there wasn't a need for it at the time, at least in terms of the first phase. Okay. If you have any more questions, please just say so.
Excuse me, it's space for taxi cabs, is that part of the?
Yes, we have curbside spaces all along here. We could also put about two, three spaces in front of the plaza, so they were part of the program.
Part, okay.
And have been accommodated. As well as we have two spaces on the, along Jefferson for Rio Transit, which is the rural transportation services, and then all other buses are internal to the site. This is showing 18 bus bays here. Currently, we have a need that the transportation providers have expressed a desire for 16 total spaces. We've provided 18 here, so we have a little bit of expansion capability, which really was, frankly, was a kind of a downside of the previous scheme. Due to the location of those bus bays, we really couldn't accommodate more than 10 on the site. This new alternative, which you know makes the bus access a little more linear, gives us much more flexibility, allows us to get more bus bays in, and it really operates more efficiently. And obviously, we'll produce more income for the city, having being able to lease more bays and more ticket counters. As we move into the design a little further, well, let me talk about this real quick. From a traffic analysis standpoint, I won't get into that in too much detail, but we did do a detailed analysis, presented it to the city traffic engineer that essentially showed that we don't have a negative impact on Adams or any of the surrounding streets by making Adams a two-way street. We still have some details to go through in terms of the changes to signals and pavement markings and so forth that would be part of the project. These
how
are just
that,
some quick...
I'm sorry, and I know you didn't want to...
Go ahead.
You didn't want to... what do you call it, to outline any additional efforts on the traffic, but how does, and I don't know if we've done this already, but doing the ingress egress one-way to the one-way in and out of those different streets, how does that affect the around the surrounding streets, and is have we considering the multimodal is going to get done, doing something different with Elizabeth and all the neighboring streets in downtown area?
Our analysis didn't go beyond the immediate yes. streets here, but it's something we could work with on, with the city traffic department on in terms of looking at the bigger picture.
I think we'd want to make downtown a little bit more pedestrian friendly as we, with a multimodal, just because of the, you know, just today, as now we look at the stats on it, we have more pedestrian traffic than we do vehicles. So.
Good point. And we had discussed at some previous meetings the fact that 14th Street is a major, this is 14th, it terminates now at the site, is a major pedestrian connection down to the Gateway Bridge, as is International. And moving the building down and putting the entrance over here at Adams and International, it would make, obviously make sense to maybe improve the sidewalks along International. The Design Advisory Committee also asked the city, anyway, to look at improving the intersections at Jefferson and International, at Adams and International in terms of crosswalks. And then one block further south at Washington and International. But it's something that needs to be looked at kind of beyond the boundaries of this site. But you're right. This is going to create more pedestrian activity in downtown, and that needs to be addressed.
Okay. Thank you.
It's part of kind of an overall master plan for downtown.
Yes.
These are just a few views kind of showing the massing of the facility. We'll still be working out the design details with the Design Advisory Committee. But what this is showing is the block of retail along International, kind of the waiting passenger waiting area in the main ticketing hall. What we've tried to attempt here is to have some form of a tower signifying the entry, an arched entryway that maybe recalls the old Missouri Pacific Railroad station, which we'll be here in a minute, and some design guidance that we were given by the Design Advisory Committee. This will just kind of walk around it. This is looking from the intersection of Jefferson and 13th back at the building. This is the canopy for the International bus bays. This is the canopy for Brownsville Urban Systems bus bays. This is looking at it from Jefferson and International. Retail in the foreground with the terminal in the background. And one thing we did look at, due to the height of the buildings between this, between Adams and the International Gateway Bridge, you would be able to see a tower at this location from the bridge, just as you came across the bridge. So it would be very prominent. You'd have a really kind of a marker as to know where you're going. Just one other view from that Adams and International intersection. And this is a ground level view from the Adams and International intersection. And again, these are very conceptual to kind of show building placement, massing, and so forth. We'll still be working out the design as we progress into it. And as part of that, we'll be looking at, you know, architectural elements, the urban design elements, how it fits in, how we do sidewalks, plazas, dealing with all the functional elements that'll drive the layout of the facility, as well as the context of Brownsville. We've been working very closely, or have had one meeting with the Design Advisory Committee. The next step after this, subject to your approval, would be going back to them, showing them the new concept, and then getting their input before we really get into what the architecture is. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
This was just another design influence. This was a rendering of the old Missouri Pacific Railroad building, and you can kind of see some of the influence we've picked up from a historical perspective of that building, which has since been demolished. It's something that was brought to us by the city. Budget, obviously, this has a budgetary influence, which is one reason we're here tonight. The original project, as approved last fall, was budgeted in $2007 of about $12 million, $11,932,000. You can see the same line items carrying across on the right. The ones that have changed are in yellow. You can see the terminal building itself went from $6.7 million to $9 million. The intercity bus boarding area, which became much larger, went from $274,000 to about $500,000. So we're going from about a $12 million project to just under a $15 million project. So we've added just about $2.8 million, or right here, the difference is $2.9 million. One thing I'd like to point out, though, that does now include about 12,000 square feet of retail, potentially income-producing retail, that was not in the original budget, and the construction cost of that retail is a little over $1 million. So you've got the opportunity now not only to have additional tenants in the facility paying rent, but you have the opportunity to produce income from the retail as well, which initially was not part of the project. I think that's it. Do you have any further questions?
I have, if I may. I'm Jim Goes. I'm the city attorney. I was involved earlier on when the acquisition process began and stuff. And you mentioned in passing that it might be necessary to acquire the service station that's adjacent to the area there.
Possibly in the future if you would desire to do so. But it's not part of the project currently.
Okay, that was what I was not clear on. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Any questions, gentlemen? Thank you, Norma.
Thank you, Norma.
Do you want to add anything to it?
No, we'll be discussing further details in executive session, and then we'll be coming back to you for a consideration and action item on the change request.
Thank you for the work you've done.
Thank you.
Okay, the item B?
Workshop item B, discussion regarding the border wall.
Okay, there's a lot of has been going on with the revelation as to where the wall may be placed, which it appears it will fortify the city from the south side. There's a lot of concerns that people have expressed to me that involve ecological concerns, that involve commerce, how it will affect commerce, and the purpose of the wall. Will it solve the intent of for what it's being built for? We have asked our legislators to consider a virtual wall, and Senator Hutchison has introduced an amendment which will take that into consideration instead of a physical wall based on geography. And Beto Cardenas, who's the aide to Senator Hutchison, just called me right before this meeting and indicated the senator will be coming down along with him hopefully this coming week to review of how it affects us here, where it will go, what's our geography like and stuff like that. So we welcome her efforts in trying to get the federal government to work with Brownsville. Our position has been since early on, the city passed a resolution against the border wall. PUB passed a resolution also against the border wall and for a virtual wall, which is based on the Rio Grande Weir Dam, which will raise the level of the water from 12 feet to 26 feet, widen the river, and back it up for 42 miles, which can be patrolled by speedboats, which can also enhance the security along with sophisticated electronic equipment on the northern perimeter and with boots on the ground. We went, the assistant city manager and myself went to a meeting in Harlingen by the Border Patrol where they were talking about the border wall. And by their own admission, the physical wall will only deter illegal immigration by 7 minutes. We believe the virtual wall that we're proposing is viable and a better solution. We're working with Mexico to make this happen. They have it under review, they're studying it. Tomorrow, I'm going to meet with the governor of Tamaulipas, who we want his support for this WIR, because it will help both communities and both sides, not only to help us build a virtual wall, but it'll help us economically to develop our area here by capturing the water that's going into the Gulf of Mexico and have it as another resource of water for industry. Based on that, I asked for this public hearing because it is unfortunate that the government's telling us one thing, that's what we heard in Harlingen, telling us they didn't know where the wall was going to go, and then Monday they reveal a map before they intend to place it. They also indicated they would be willing to work with local leaders. They never contacted us to work with us as to what we're doing, how is the proposed WIR going to could be utilized based on the geography instead of a physical wall. Based on that, we're calling this public hearing to hear from you, see what you have to say. There is a delegation going from this area to Washington in early November. It'll be composed of mayors and county judges from El Paso to Brownsville to travel to Washington on this issue. Yesterday we had a conference call with the mayors and county judges on this issue, and there was a consensus there to oppose a physical wall and to support a virtual wall. So if anyone wants to speak for it or against it, this is the time, and we welcome your input. Please make your comments respectfully, address them to me, and make them constructive, whether your opinion is for or against it. We value it and we welcome it. Thank you.
Mayor, I want to make a comment before anyone else addresses the commission.
You have the floor, Commissioner.
My comment, Mayor, is the following, that a lot of these meetings, I wish we'd have some input. If and when Senator Hutchison does come down to Brownsville or the Valley, if we'd be able to participate in that meeting. And the reason being is many of these meetings, and you've been traveling quite extensively, this commission has no input or to back you up. You are the mayor of Brownsville. I believe you need our support at many of these meetings that have to deal with not just Brownsville, but this entire state. And I think we could provide more support to you if we were aware and if we could accompany you every now and then on a couple of these meetings and or on some of these trips. I don't know, I'm not sure how you feel about that, but I feel that many of these meetings this commission has not been aware of, and I think we have we should have every opportunity to either not join you, attend, and allow some input, because we do represent we do also represent City of Brownsville.
And you're more than welcome to, Commissioner, you're more than welcome to. I just got the call, I guess it 5 o'clock from Senator Hutchison. I'm letting you know right now, so when they come, you'd be more than happy to join them. And the notice we got, Charlie Yala, on the meeting in Harlingen, that was just for mayors, or how was it that you know of? They just notified us and we went?
It's a week.
A week, that's it. So, I mean, it's nothing that nobody's trying to... you're more than happy to attend, but I get notice from the city manager or whatever, and I go. I mean, I'm sure nobody's going to stop you from going. But
let me say something too, real quick. When Eddie Trevino was here, he got invited to a lot of these border committees with the mayors. None of us were invited. And I'm not saying you shouldn't, we should all reach out, but most of these things, just most of these meetings are just requiring the mayor. And I was upset with that too. I got invited through the McAllen Chamber of Commerce to go to that meeting when John Cornyn came down. But for the most part, these invitations are going strictly out. And when Eddie Trevino went to Washington, none of us went. You know what I mean? He went on behalf to talk about the border wall, and none of us were invited. You know what I mean? To me, it's just something that these mayors are getting together, and should they include commissioners? Damn straight they should. Why they haven't, I don't know. I don't know where they're getting at, but you know, I'd like to see more involvement, like you said, from our commissioners, because there's a lot of us here that have a lot to say. Me, for one, being a customs agent, ex-customs agent, we're still pending. I'm still pending that. I mean, I have a lot of insight on how this border's been run for the last 10 years, 15 years, and they need to hear the stories. You know, this virtual wall, it needs to be a reality because they never gave it a chance before.
And I just want to, again, I just want to make it known. And, Commissioner, I totally agree. I'm not going to single anybody out or say, you know, if it's the mayor's, why can't we go? No, and obviously, if the mayor, you know, it's mayor's conference, mayor's meetings. That's correct. I think there's other meetings that need to take place that I think this commission should be invited, if not acknowledge it, so that we should be,
I agree with you. I agree with you.
If I may, I think the big issue is here, I think a lot of us are opposed to the physical wall. I think a lot of us are very concerned about the location or the proposed location of a physical wall. And if we don't act together and if we don't participate together as a community, well, they're just going to do what they want to, because you don't start talking about putting fencing up on a levee system without already talking to the owners of the levee. The federal government is moving forward with this. They have their own idea and their own agenda about where they want to do this and how they want to do it. And if we don't start acting together as a unit, as a community, well, then they're going to do what they want to.
Yep.
And we need to participate, and everybody needs to be involved, and not just the city commissioners, but the people of Brownsville, the people of Cameron County, because this is going to affect us, and it's going to affect us negatively, because we do so much business as a region. And if we don't think as a region, then we're going to get cut off, and our border crossings are going to continue to decrease. People aren't going to cross into Matamoros as much as they have. We're already seeing that effect on our local economy, and we need to take steps to improve, not to decrease our revenues.
Can I say something to that? If you look where we are, you know, I'm sure up there in Washington, they look at where are we going to get hit the least. Well, you know what? Let's put it in Brownsville. People don't vote, and votes mean a lot to politicians, and for this. And if you all saw the map, where it's going, it's the lowest voter turnout. So the hit is lessened because they know up there that they can survive a hit. Because down here we don't vote. That's our biggest problem down here. And I would like, in our channel for Channel 12, to put the names of the congressmen that people at home need to contact. The way to get to these congressmen and to hold them accountable is to let them know that we're writing to them every day, let them know that we're holding. Even though our voter turnout isn't much, we still care, and we do have connections. I think there's a lot of good people in Brownsville with connections, and those people need to stay up and play their politics with the politics in Washington, because until that happens, they're going to put up the wall here whether we like it or not. Until we fight, until we let them know there's alternatives, as such as Ware Dam, this virtual wall, they have to look at these things, but they're not going to care if nobody stands up and gets involved and contacts the congressman, Democrat and Republican.
That's very well said. Commissioner Cabanilla, so there's no perception here that may be misleading. The Texas Border Coalition is composed of mayors and county judges. It's not mayors and commissioners. The most recent event by Homeland Security, which is regional with Cameron County Judge Carlos Cascos, had an event Sunday, for instance. I really didn't want to go. Sunday's, you know, great day to have to put in a long, long week. But I was invited to go. I mean, it didn't say mayor and commissioners, it was just mayor. So, you know, I mean, it's not,
just
I'm not trying to slight you.
No, I know.
And the invitation was for, I think, the chief of police, right? okay? It was a very specific invitation, so, I mean, that's beyond my control. I can't control that. Now, we've spoken with one voice. This city commission passed a resolution against the wall. As your mayor, I'm standing up for that voice that you all passed through a resolution, and so did PUB. But they're hosting rallies. I was at the rally. I'm having this workshop to give you the opportunity to get involved, and I want you to get involved. But there's certain things that I'm limited to what I can do or what I can't do. But this is your opportunity to listen to the citizens and participate with the citizens as to how you feel about the wall. So having said that, I'm going to open it up to the public to
state their comments. Before that, can we get a voice from other commissioners?
Anybody wants to be heard, just ask me.
What's your thought on the wall, Carlos?
You know where I stand. I signed the proclamation. We're against it.
Good.
I've already emailed both the congressman and the senators up there.
The only thing I'd like to add is...
Charlie. Huh? I don't know if you've emailed them, but I already emailed them.
The only thing I'd like to add is that, you know, if... And this is, I think, in the same line as what Commissioner Camarillo is indicating, is I don't think it's necessarily that anybody feels slighted or feels like we've been left out. I think what we're saying here and what we want to express to the community is that we need to get involved and y'all need to get involved and we need to communicate with each other no matter what other personal differences there may be. This is something that affects all of us. And it's something that if we don't work together as a team, as a community, it's going to seriously impact our landscape. And it's going to seriously impact what type of perception people have of downtown Brownsville. And I couldn't imagine having to go to a checkpoint to get to a college class. I mean, it's such a blight on our landscape the way it's being proposed, and especially considering the location of ITEC and UTB. And having to get across town where there's a barrier.
Thank you, Commissioner. And again, does anybody have anything else to say before I open up to the public?
I am against the physical wall, and I am in favor of a virtual wall. Okay. And I do concur with commissioners as far as working together as one. The city of Brownsville and us commissioners and the mayor, we should all work together.
That's great, Commissioner. And like I said, I speak as one voice based on the resolution you all passed here against the wall, and I will continue to speak against it as your mayor, and I'll do my part as far as making sure that our voice is heard as a community. Now, one of the things that was pointed out to me very interestingly when I talked to Senator Hutchinson's aide, Beto Cardenas, he said, what goes on with the private landowners and the government, whether they agree to give them access, it's like they're looking at it and acknowledging that it's okay, to build a fence there. But when it comes to city property, because they came to the city to try to get access to city land, okay, that's a different story. That's what he's telling me now. But my concern is this, that the landowners perhaps felt intimidated into allowing the federal government to go in their land to survey and do whatever they're preparing for the wall. And that's why I put out the press release and I invited the landowners to give them the opportunity, or maybe we have to look for a different way to contact them, give them the opportunity to tell us how they really feel about the wall. I don't know what they signed, if they're locked into it or if they can a test that they felt intimidating to signing. I don't know, because we haven't heard from them. And that's the purpose of this hearing. But again, we maybe have to find a different avenue of contacting them to finding out, because as a community, we must unite together and I believe stand against the wall, because I think it's for all the wrong reasons. They're confusing illegal immigration with terrorism security. I am for legal immigration. I am for trade with security, and I think we're all for that. Unfortunately, some people have it confused that they think that by putting, in my opinion, a physical wall, that's going to shield us from illegal immigration, and that's not going to happen. I think the proposal of raising the river and all that stuff is more viable. It's, more. Well, your customs, what do you think? I mean,
well, like I said, the terrorists that Customs caught a couple terrorists going to bomb LAX. They didn't come through the border down here. They came through Canada. The intel that we had, everything, there's more likely coming up from up there. Down here, it's just a ploy to stop illegal immigration. They're throwing the word terrorists in there to scare. That's all it is. Kay Bailey Hutchinson came down 4 or 5 years ago, and she promised us officers the equipment and the technology. Never came. They never gave this virtual wall a chance. They never manned the bridges the way they should have. You know, we had a meeting with Solomon Ortiz. Solomon Ortiz invited us to a dinner and brought the appropriation, the congressman for the appropriations, who was appropriating the money for the wall.
David Price. Huh? David Price.
David Price. And his attitude was, it's coming. And then the Border Patrol chief from McAllen was like, come hell or high water, it's coming no matter what. So I felt like, why are we there then? If you already know it's coming, why are we here if you're trying to listen to us? Are you appeasing us, or what are you doing? This money's our, this fence is coming. Now, what we can do is kind of form a way on how it comes. Some of the ideas with this Weir Dam and building seawalls to reconstruct our levees, I'm sure the federal government should have an open eye on making that work before they put a huge wall up and Mexico owns the Rio Grande River. I'm sure we don't want that. And, you know, a lot of my ploys with the government, and while I'm going through all this with the government, was my fight for better equipment, better manpower. If we give the manpower a chance, it stimulates growth. You put 1,000 new agents on the border, they're going to buy houses, they're going to spend money in Brownsville, and our economy is going to grow. You put a wall there, it's not going to solve anything. It's not going to solve anything. And these people know it, but they're just... Congressmen are blaming it on CBP, Customs Border Protection. Customs Border Protection is telling the congressman, yeah, we want it. As a union president still, and my brother, Union President McAllen, we run over 800 employees. I can tell you over 90% are not in favor of this wall. We have over 13,000 agents across on the border from here to California. I can tell you right now, a lot of them don't want the wall. But the congressmen are throwing it on CBP. Well, CBP has the intel. They want it. I don't believe that. CBP saying, well, the congressmen want it. You know, so everybody's throwing it off on each other to where at the end, the only people who are going to lose are the people that live in our city when that wall goes up. And if we don't make a stand, and it takes a lot to make a stand, trust me, the federal government, it's huge. They don't like what you're saying. They're going to come up. They're going to stand up against you. But it's those people who fight for what they believe in are the people that end up making things better for people in the United States and in Brownsville.
That's very good. Well said. I think also part of the problem is because of 9/11, our legislators in Washington are trying to appease mid-America with a wall. They figured a wall will provide the security. And I think it's a sense false security by building a wall, because a wall's proven not to work, whether it's Berlin, China, they just don't work. If they want to build a wall, they ought to build it whoever feels threatened. Is New York threatened? Well, build a wall around your state, see if you would like it, you know? They probably wouldn't like that. It's like, to me, I simulated like building a prison behind your house. You know, it destroys the integrity of our landscape here. It affects our ecological system here. It also is not good policy for good neighbor relations. Like I said, we're for legal immigration, for trade with security, but the wall is not the answer. I think there's alternatives, and I think they should be explored, and if they're viable and effective, they should be considered first before a wall. I took the liberty also as mayor, because, you know, I come in contact with a lot of people I come in contact with all the mayors from El Paso to Brownsville on this issue. I took the liberty of inviting some attorneys to come and speak to the commission later on in executive session to explore the options we have, because this is very serious. This is going to affect us tremendously. And there's a lot of things that people don't understand as far as the dynamics of the wall, what it implies to Brownsville, especially the way it's being presented. It's a fortress. They're fortifying our city from the south side. So, Mr. This first speaker, Resty, you want to speak on this?
I just want to say one more thing, too. After 911, we had 9 officers per each shift at the Bridge of Brownsville. That lasted for a few months till the money ran out. And we went back to 4 officers on the bridge. So the perception was, oh, yeah, we need to stop being reactive as a government and being proactive, because it all comes back down to money and budget. And that's what they've never really given the manpower down here a chance to do their job. They haven't given the equipment, the technology, to really do the job down here. And people like me are going to voice their opinion, maybe get fired like I did. I don't know. But you know what? It's people like me who end up, and people like people on this commission who are willing to stand up against the wall, and people at home that want to fight what's going on. And it takes a lot. It takes a lot out of you, and they test you. But if we stick together, I think we can't go wrong. And I'd rather have 9 officers right now when nothing's going on, not just to appease and give the perception that we're doing our job. And we're only doing our job till the money runs out. All this money that's going to go toward a wall should go to the manpower, to the technology, and give it a chance. Just a little eye-opener for a lot of y'all.
Mr. Resty,
I think you're safe.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Basically, I'm not going to speak for or against. I'm just going to say if the fence is built, it would not affect me. If the fence is not built, it would not affect me neither. But there are pros and cons, which I'm hearing. Some of the pros are it will hinder the push-pull factors of economics for the illegal people coming from Mexico, Central America, Asia, and South America. It would hinder the drug flow into this area. It would hinder the border bandits, which a lot of people don't report. It would hinder some of the environmental mess that's being left behind by the illegal people crossing. There's a lot of trash out there. When I was a National Guard member, we used to patrol. Not patrol, but we had duty. And we found so much trash, paper, clothing, everything. And it washes back into the river and it goes into the Gulf of Mexico. It would double our security. It would hinder the increase of chronic diseases coming from this country's by people. And we do have to provide the health issue here. It would hinder a terrorist track. Now, some people say there is no terrorist. We are at war. And it's going to be a long time. I probably will die and we'll still be under this terrorist threat. But there are cons to this. If it's not built, will there be more illegal crossings in our city? Will there be more drugs coming into our city? Will there be more deaths crossing the river? Will there be more border bandits? Would this be a burden on the city of Brownsville for its resources that we have to provide, like more security by our police, which are not patrolling or picking up anyone? It's funny that in Brownsville, there are many subdivisions that have walls and fences to keep who out. If I would go into those areas, those subdivisions that have gates, huge walls, and if I would go in there, I'd probably be arrested because I don't belong in that subdivision. It's funny how we have walls within our own city to protect who, okay? We talk about the WEIR project, raising the water level up to 26 feet. It will affect our levee system. Our levee system has not been tested since Hurricane Beulah in 1967. If we're going to raise that water level, it's going to raise the water table. We are going to have more problems there. Basically, a lot of people I talk to really don't know which way to go. And they told me to come up here, and I said, well, if it's built, okay. If it's not built, it's okay. And like someone said right now, it's going to be built. But if the city does take the actions that you are speaking by diverting it in a certain way which won't affect the city, which is, it will be helpful, and that will be great. But we have to be careful with the WEIR project. I think there are 3 major animals in Brownsville. The ocelot, which is still here. The jerguandi, which is gone already. It's dead. And a little thing called a horned toad. And I remember when I was young in the 50s, it was everywhere, but we destroyed that. So environmentally, we have to look at ourselves first here. But will the wall affect these animals? Well, we don't know until it's built. And if it's not built, I'll still be happy. I thank you, Mayor. I thank you, Commissioners, for allowing me to speak. Thank you, sir.
And let me respond to one thing that you said, Mr. Oreste. The studies, the engineering studies, I'm not an expert. I'm not an engineer, and I'm not going to pretend to be an engineer. The engineering studies done on the weir do not indicate that it would adversely impact the levees nor the water table. That's based on the engineering studies that are being reviewed right now by the Mexican government. They have been permitted by the U.S. government, okay? So I just wanted to point that out. And you're welcome to look at the studies there at PUB there, okay? Okay. Okay, would you like to speak? Please state your name. And thank you for helping host that rally. I know, Charlie, you attended, and I attended. I don't know who else attended for the commission, but it was a great rally. Commissioner Camarillo, okay.
Thank you, and thank you for honoring us with your presence. We appreciate it. My name is Stephanie Herwick, and I'm here from the group No Border Wall. We're a grassroots group, and I have spoken to you before. I think it's important what Commissioner Atkinson was saying about how we really all need to get involved, and I wanted to come to share with the commission and also with the public one possibility for that, and that is that Customs and Border Patrol has begun the process of an environmental impact study. And this environmental impact study is not just the impacts on the environment for wildlife, it's also the human environment, our communities, our economies, as well as the wildlife habitats. And what we've done is created a guide for writing comments about that, towards that environmental impact statement. The public comment period ends on October 15th. So it's very important that in addition to coming here to the city council meeting, that we let the federal government know what we think about the wall and what some of the problems are. And we spoke to, in developing this list, which I'm going to distribute, we spoke to environmentalists who have dealt with this environmental impact process before. And what they said was, and their advice was, to raise as many issues as possible. Because the more issues that you raise, the more issues that they'll have to contend with when they're doing the study. So what we've created is a list that includes habitat, endangered and rare species, like Mr. Uresti was just discussing, the ocelot, the jaguarundi, the violation of the International Migratory Bird Treaty, what are the impacts of construction on the wall that the wall would have, the economic impact, impact on our communities, like we were talking about with separating UTB, the impact on agriculture, how much farmland is going to be taken out of production and how will farmers access river water, impact on flood control and how is it going to affect the operation of the levees, relationships with Mexico and the rest of the world. And then we also have on here problems with the scope of the environmental impact study. One of the things that we were told is that they're using little pieces of it as a way to narrow the focus so that it makes the environmental impact seem sort of more limited than it actually is, but taken as a whole, and assuming that we one day do have 700 miles of border wall, some of it stretching from Laredo to Brownsville, what are the impacts, you know, going forward? So I would appreciate the opportunity to distribute this little handout to you and also to the public, and would appreciate it if everyone would spread it far and wide and make sure that you make your voices heard. The contact information is on the back. There's an email, there's physical mail, there's a fax number, and there's also a way to submit it electronically on their website, which is borderfencenepa.com.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And feel free to pass it around. The assistant city manager, I had him prepare a little petition. Can you read it out, the petition, or have somebody read it for me? Thank you. It'll be in the back there for those who want to sign it. Would you, City Secretary, would you please read the petition?
Mayor, I have it, and I'll read it for you.
This is the chance for the community to get involved.
The heading for the petition says, "We, the undersigned, hereby express our opposition to the proposed border wall that would construct 69.9 miles of physical border fence along the border with Mexico, including the Brownsville, Texas sector."
Okay. It's 69.9 miles.
69.9 miles.
Okay. And I guess you could put the petition on that table right there.
We have some outside.
You have some out there?
And we'll put another one out here.
Okay. Mr. Reese.
Mayor, Commissioners, good afternoon. Fernando Reese, ladies and gentlemen. The Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo of 1848 and the Gadsden Purchase establishes the International Boundary Commission on the Mexican side and the American side. We have a commissioner and engineers that from the San Diego to the mouth of the Rio Grande surveyed all this land. The jurisdiction of the river is of the International Boundary Commission, now International Boundary and Water Commission. Their main concern is the current of the river and the banks only. I have been attending these meetings since the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, we met at the Civic Center. I continue to inform, and I will inform you, that the jurisdiction of the river is the International Boundary and Water Commission only, exclusively. They report to the Interior Department on the American side and their counterpart on the Mexican side. The senators, the president, the congressmen, they have nothing to do with subject matter. The people think that the Rio Grande is in a straight line. No. From the area from El Paso, the river has meanders. And in the from here from Brownsville to the mouth of the Rio Grande, we have a lot of meanders. You can cover a straight mile, it's 10 miles, but with all the meanders of the river, you're probably talking about 30 miles. So this is not an easy solution. I have lived here all my life. I know all the people from the Border Patrol since when they first got here. There are two types of illegals. The first illegals are the ones that had permits, passports to come to Brownsville to buy things and everything. They used to stay here. Some of them, for example, were maids and things like that. They returned to their homes, and they would come every day. The other illegals are the ones that just pass the river, and they go all the way to Alaska now. And you'd be surprised. Those people are hardworking people that come here for the benefit of their families so that they can have a better life. But I'll tell you what, the majority of the people that cross the river with permits, a lot of them are undesirable people that have invaded our neighborhoods. They have invaded our neighborhoods. I don't have anything against those people, those poor people that want to cross and go up north. They migrated since the 1860s, the first migration, after a little bit before the Civil War. They go and look for a better life. A lot of them stayed in the northern states, and now others are staying in Alaska. But this weir, I don't know where it's going to be built, but you have to think about all the meanders and how far is that weir going to be from the mouth of the river. Because if you're going to hold the water back to build a virtual wall, whatever you want to call it, what's going to happen with the remainder of the territory from the weir to the mouth of the river? Northwest Passage. No water. Over here we have ice. It's melting now. We're going to have what? What are we going to have so that from the weir to the mouth of the river? I don't know why this weir is such a big issue here. Really, I'm really totally against it, and I don't know what's behind all this, but you will learn a lesson about what the constituency has to go through when we come here and speak to you. Now you all are going to go before higher echelons in government, and they're going to say and do the same thing to you as you all do to us. Good afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Reese. Okay, it's time. Well, we have one more on the weir. Ramon Perez, Mr. Perez. And then we're gonna go to a regular meeting, please. No, it's fine, please. You're in the subject matter, so let's hear from you on it.
There was already said.
That's fine.
How are y'all doing?
Thank you, Mr. Perez. Go ahead.
My name is Roman, R-O-M-A-N, Perez. I hope you can read that. I have just four quick comments, hopefully I can make it quickly enough. Now, I'm not necessarily for it, against it, just like Mr. Estein was mentioned.
Why not?
Why not? Because I think we have to have a complete dialogue on it, to be honest with you.
We have to have a dialogue,
and we don't have a dialogue here, in part because you have an ad that appeared in the Brownsville Herald on page section A and 6. They made it seem as though you only wanted one side of the story, and I prefer to have a dialogue as a community to decide whether we're in favor of it, necessarily a virtual wall, a physical wall, no wall at all, and it seems as though you just wanted one side of the story.
So you haven't done...
Mr. Perez, you're welcome to express your position.
Mm-hmm.
We're going based on the resolution passed at that time.
Yeah, I know you just spent $380 of money, and we're in...
And I know you understand that.
Yeah, okay, no, I do. Okay.
But we
how
welcome...
How did you research that and not know whether you want the...
I don't have to research
the wall or not.
Call me itself.
But
you all...
I mean, you got to get involved in different ways.
I think we should let it speak.
Commissioner, that's his option, okay?
How far
he wants to exercise that option, that's up to him, and we welcome your input, either for, against, or neutral.
I'm not necessarily in favor
neutral,
of it or against
it. Fine.
You don't want me to speak. No,
I
think you need
to speak. We want to hear from you.
Everybody's entitled to their own
please.
Opinion.
Please.
Yeah.
Exactly,
I mean,
Mayor.
Yeah. Please.
Okay.
Go forward.
My problem necessarily was the fact that you all spent at the most $380 for an ad of money that we're already in debt, $1.7 million. We had to go into the reserves to pay for this ad, and that was a concern of mine as a citizen and as a taxpayer. My other concern was we are in debt, and the city mayor and the city commission, it seems as though you all want to sue the federal government and put an injunction on the federal government, thus spending more money of our tax dollars. And I don't know if you realize, but we are, again, in debt, and we need to realize that before we go ahead and start suing, and you have meetings with attorneys there in an executive session, which we as the public are not privy to. And I wish you would allow the attorneys to come and speak, because we as a community do have to have a dialogue, not just the one-sided story that we are not in favor of a physical wall, and you've decided for us as city leaders that you want just a virtual wall or no wall at all. Our relationship with Mexico and Matamoros is strong, and I know it is, just because I've not been in Brownsville very long, and I can tell the relationship between families that live in Matamoros and live in Brownsville are so viable, so very strong, that I truly believe that as an individual, as a family, have family that live in Matamoros, in-laws anyway, that a wall would not necessarily destroy our culture, our bi-national, our bi-city, our twin sister. If our relationship is so weak that a physical wall would deter us from being able to be friends, that's, to me, signals that our relationship with Matamoros is not as strong as you necessarily claim it is. And my other problem that I have is with the Weir Project. And you claimed earlier, Mayor, that the city, that PUB has done research that the water table would not necessarily be affected. It doesn't make any sense, and I've not done the research. I'm not like Mr. Ruiz, who's done the research, it seems as though, and you, Mayor, that have done the research on the water table. But if you raise the water table, the water level 26 feet from where it is right now, where it's just like a little stream, I think that the water would somehow have to seep in and already weaken the already weak ground that we have. There is a reason why the university does not have buildings higher than three stories. It's not just for the aesthetic looks, but it's also because they're probably afraid that what happened to El Jardín Hotel as a historian might happen to us, might happen to that particular buildings that they're building there. And if you already have all of this water backed up behind the dam, it doesn't make it makes sense that if we were to have floods upriver, that all that water would come in and maybe seep into the levees, and we do not want another North New Orleans or Katrina accident. And on top of that, you'd have to have mandatory flood insurance. The FEMA's already directing some people, once they bring in the flood maps, that if you have a weir, it's going to extend the flood insurance mandate by the federal government, and it's going to cause more citizens to have to pay more money than they're already paying on their expensive homes, and they might have to be kicked out because they're having to have homes foreclosed. And on top of that, we as an entity seem very, very happy to get highway funding, get funding for customs, for immigration, INS, or whatever, CIS, ICE, whatever it's called now, Social Security, Medicaid, Medicare. But the one time that Washington is asking us to make some sort of sacrifice, other than just go shopping because the terrorists would win, we don't shop, that we're trying to, they're asking us for a sacrifice, and it seems as though you don't necessarily want a sacrifice, it makes me wonder whether we're being very closed-minded, as you all claim that the people in Washington are being closed-minded. But we do need to have a dialogue, not just a one-sided debate. So I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. Okay, let's go into our regular meeting. Let's see. Item one,
proclamations.
National Breast Cancer Awareness. Is there somebody here to receive that?
Yes, Mrs. Buchan is present.
Yeah.
Stella Buchan, are you present?
Can you come forward, please?
Stand up there in front, right there.
Would you please read the proclamations?
Stand over here,
ma'am. Please.
No.
Hi,
how are you?
Congratulations. How you doing?
A proclamation of the City Commission of Brownsville, Texas, designating October 2007 as National Breast Cancer Awareness Month in our city. Whereas October 2007 is National Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and October 19, 2007 is National Mammography Day, and whereas breast cancer is the most common cancer among women, except for non-melanoma skin cancers, and breast cancer is the second leading cause of death in women, exceeded only by lung cancer, and whereas the chances of developing invasive breast cancer at some time in a woman's life is about 1 in 7, and almost 178,480 new cases of female invasive breast cancer will be diagnosed in 2007, and about 40,460 will die from the disease, and whereas an estimated 2,030 cases of male breast cancer will be diagnosed in 2007, and about 450 men will die of the disease, and whereas death rates from breast cancer have been declining, and this change is believed to be the result of earlier detection and improved treatment, and whereas mammography, an X-ray of the breast, is recognized as the single most effective method of detecting breast changes that may be cancer long before physical symptoms can be seen or felt. Now, therefore, we, the members of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, by virtue of the authority vested by the charter of said city, do hereby designate October 2007 as National Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and October 19, 2007 is National Mammography Day in the City of Brownsville. Done this the second day of October 2007, signed by Mayor Pat Almada and City Commission.
Bless you. And again.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, man.
Mayor, Commissioners, and distinguished guests, I was going to read a little bit and let you know about the breast cancer, but since it's already in the proclamation, the only thing I want to say that on October 11, 2004, I was informed by my doctor that I had breast cancer. I am a survivor. Mayor and Commissioners, thank you for this proclamation and recognizing October as National Breast Cancer Awareness Month.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Okay,
second
domestic violence awareness proclamation.
Domestic violence awareness.
Is there somebody here to receive? Okay.
A proclamation of the City of Brownsville, Texas, declaring October 2007 as Domestic Violence Awareness Month in our city. Whereas Domestic Violence Awareness Month evolved from the first day of unity observed on the first Monday in October 1981 by the National Coalition Against Domestic Violence for the purpose of joining battered women's advocates across the nation working to end violence against women and their children, and whereas Domestic violence is a serious crime that affects people of all races, ages, income levels, and sexes, and violates an individual's privacy, dignity, security, and humanity due to the systematic use of physical, emotional, sexual, psychological, and economic control and abuse. And as a result, at least one woman is battered every 9 seconds. And whereas family violence statistics in Texas for the year 2006 recorded 186,868 incidents of family violence against a current or former spouse or intimate partner, including 120 women who were killed in an act of domestic violence, along with 2,135 calls of family violence reported by the Brownsville Police Department. And whereas in the city of Brownsville, no woman or child should live in fear in the home, on the street, or on the job. And whereas the city of Brownsville is committed to participating and supporting Friendship of Women and the Cameron County Family Violence Task Force to continue to facilitate a countywide approach to address the needs of victims of domestic violence, to work and to end domestic violence in the city of Brownsville. Now, therefore, we, the members of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, by virtue of the authority vested by the charter of said city and on behalf of all our citizens, do hereby proclaim October 2007 as Domestic Violence Awareness Month in our city and further encourage all our citizens to become aware of the tragedy of domestic violence. Done on this, the second day of October 2007, signed by Mayor Pat Almada and City Commissioners.
Thank you. Do you want to say something?
Good evening, City Commissioners. Honorable Mayor, thank you also very much for your support. We are glad that you help us recognize this important epidemic in our community, and we work very hard every day to help the clients that we do within our community as well, and with local law enforcement and district attorney and other pertinent individuals within the community. So we really appreciate your support on this, and we look forward to seeing some of you at our walk and our vigil later within this month. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the next Employee of the Month, please.
Item 2, Employee of the Month.
Mayor, members of the Commission, please help me welcome our Employee of the Month for October, Daniel Clark.
Chief.
As you can see, Daniel Clark is one of our excellent bus drivers at our transit, our urban system bus. Mm. He has been selected Employee of the Month twice within his own department. He's considered very excellent record, driving record, and attendance record. He has a tremendous relationship with all the passengers that ride his bus, to the point that they even want to teach him Spanish and help him with that. So
all right.
He's always got a nice personality, nice smile, and he shows a willingness to learn and continue to help other bus drivers that have less experience than him. So we're very proud of him, and as Employee of the Month, he gets our pin,
thank you very much,
our hat, and our plaque in recognition for outstanding service rendered to the City of Brownsville for the month of October.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
He should get a day off.
He does get a day off.
He does get a day off? Okay.
He's a passenger. Pending permission from the passengers on his bus, so he got a day off.
Congratulations.
And, of course, he's eligible for the Employee of the Year at our December banquet in December.
So. Congratulations. Adelaide.
Thank you.
That's great.
Thank you very much. I appreciate this. This is a great honor. I've never had this bestowed on me as an Employee of the Month. It's nice. Thank you very much.
Oh, you deserve it. Thank you. The public comment, the first one is Robert Oresti. Please direct your comments. You have 3 minutes. Let's see, how many people do we have here? 1, 2, 3, 5. We're going to put it down to 2 minutes each to cover everybody, okay?
Thank you, Mayor.
Stella, would you please take the time?
Yes.
Direct your comments to me, please.
Again, thank you, Mayor. I changed what I was going to say. The only thing I would like to say to the Mayor and the Commissioners is that when you became mayor, you made a mayor's comments, and I would like to see that all the commissioners be given 3 minutes also to give what is happening in their districts, to see what progress, what is going on in their districts. I would like to see each commissioner given those 3 minutes to explain to the public what has happened the last month. People want to know what's going on. A lot of us are in the dark. A lot of us, people tell me all the time, what are they doing up there? They're not doing anything. I don't see any progress. It would be nice. The mayor did a presentation, and it would be nice that each commissioner does a presentation. What are you doing? Are you going to be accountable to the voters? That's what I'm asking. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Agosti. Second is Stephanie Herwick. Ms. Herwick? She's not here?
She was with the border wall.
Okay. John Shergo? Mr. Shergo?
Two minutes, Mayor?
Yeah, that's fine.
First of all, I want to just say why I'm here today. One of the things that I love about Brownsville is the people who live here, the spirit and the quality of life that we all have. And one of the things I think that we all are kind of getting a little worried about and a little concerned is our postal system. I think that every one of the postal workers does a great job. I'm not here to complain about the workers in the Postal Service. Not at all. They're doing a great job with the resources that they have. Those are great working people, and they ought to be applauded every day when I get up and go to work. But I'm asking the commission today is to realize that although this is not a federal body, you do have a lot of authority and you have a lot of pull. And what I suggest is each one of these gentlemen that sit here in the commission think about passing a resolution stating that we would act to have our federal congressman to take a look at the situation that is going on in our community and our lack of postal service. We have one postal center full-time all the time to service over 150,000 residents. Now let me ask every one of you gentlemen a question. You have a lot of priorities and you've got a lot of problems that you're dealing with and things, but think about it. Do you think the people who live in Austin, Texas, I defy anyone who will tell me that someone in Austin, Texas, or Dallas, Texas, or Wichita Falls, Texas, would allow this type of system to occur in the United States? We're talking about a border wall. We are in the United States. We deserve to have the same postal service as any citizen in the United States. And why is it that we only have one postal center? And when you drive in there, it's like trying to go through a demolition derby, with all due respect. People are crunched in there, treated as if that, you know, a 40-minute line today I waited in. With all due respect, Mayor, there's only four people.
Can you just brief it up, please?
Thank you. I would state that if you guys want to do something that's really important, that can really affect the lives of each and every one of our citizens, go ahead and form a committee, form some concerned citizens, have them go ahead and write a report, investigate why it is that we have the system that we have here with the postal problems, and have them report back to the mayor, and then have a resolution passed by each one of you gentlemen stating that the citizens of Brownsville, Texas, deserve the same postal service as any other citizen in this country.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We already did it, John.
Mr. Resendez, Pastor, there was Mr. Ramon Perez, you already spoke, so okay. It's fine.
Mayor, with all due respect, commissioners and mayor, my name is Alex Resendez, and since 1970, I've been preaching the Bible. My God has something for Brownsville. I believe it strongly. But so happens that United States of America and my president, they seem to think that there's no Congress. Okay? I want to say not only to you, Mayor, and the commissioners here, with all due respect, and with all due respect to my President of the United States of America, George Bush, that the Americas is not America. The Americas start South America, North America, and United States of America. It's not only United States, America. If we go into war, Mexico is supposed to help us. Central America is supposed to help us. And all South America is supposed to help us. I know you all know this. What I'm trying to say is that these border fence, I agree with you, you should sue them, the government or whoever you have to sue. It's an insult. Reagan said, bring down the fence of Berlin. The Nazis had dogs that they were biting people, they were killing people because they were trained. Are we going to do the same thing with Mexico? Are we going to have dogs so they can kill the Mexicans when they're trying to come over here? Now, I do agree that we need to control terrorism and we need to control the drug enforcement. But we should get more soldiers or another way of doing it. Because Mexico has Mexicans here fighting for us in the war, and they're carne de cañón. That's what our daddy used to tell us. My dad went to Japanese war. My brother was in Vietnam. I was sent to Frankfurt over there to fight the Germans. And that's all I have to say. May the United States understand that it's not only the United States, it's the Americas.
Thank you, Mr. Resendez.
We need them. They come and work. In New Orleans, they're throwing them in jail because they're selling tacos, but they're uplifting New Orleans. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's go to the consent items, item four.
Item four, consent agenda items A through J.
Move to approve.
Second.
Has everybody reviewed the minutes? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Item five.
Item five, consideration and action to appoint or reappoint one member to the Brownsville Public Utilities Board.
Mayor, I move to appoint Mr. Manny Vasquez.
Second.
Before you appoint Manny Vasquez, let me tell you, he was in the Brownsville Housing Authority. I removed him from the Brownsville Housing Authority for micromanagement and abuse to...
Don't take that kind of a cheap shot on somebody in public.
Staff.
Don't take that kind of a cheap shot of somebody in public.
Don't you do that.
You do not know Manuel Vasquez. You do not know Emmanuel Vasquez. And you are going against something and you are ridiculing a person that has done good for this community.
Sir,
don't you dare disrespect a person of this
city
community.
Attorney.
Have there been any findings?
City Attorney, was he scheduled for a hearing and asked to resign?
I think we're all out of order in this forum. I think we should all probably...
Done a lot of good for this
Jim,
community,
a motion has been made.
But I think what you're doing here is a disservice.
Mayor, are you disregarding the motion, Mayor?
No, I'm conducting the meeting.
Let's
and
follow
I will call for, and I will.
Well, I think that you made some statements without any findings of fact.
I will call for the vote. I'm just letting you know that I think this is not the way to do it. Chris Valadez has raised over $150,000 for the poor. And you're removing him to get back at me?
This has nothing to do with the poor, Mayor.
You
this
keep
has
thinking that this
has
about
all
you,
to do
Pat.
With Bronzeville.
Just
it's
go.
Not about you, Pat.
Just do it. Just do it. You have a motion. You have a second. All in favor for Manny Vasquez?
Aye.
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 All against? No.
Nay. Nay.
I think it was 4-3.
Okay. You have Manny Vasquez.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item six.
Item six, consideration and action to appoint or reappoint citizens to the Brownsville Citizens
That's
Advisory
okay.
Committee.
We'll get it done. Item six.
Move to appoint Jesse Quisada.
Second.
Okay. We have a motion.
Hold on, who is he real quick?
Jesse Quisada.
Can you tell me about him?
Sure, he's an attorney. He works for a local law firm. If you'd like his resume, I can get that to you.
It's a local law firm.
Would you?
Whose appointment is this?
Go ahead.
City Attorney?
I'm just doing what you do.
On the Citizens Advisory Committee, Mayor, I'm not aware if it's done by commissioners.
Mayor, there's a chart on the screen. I believe Mr. Triani has a vacancy.
Oh, okay.
He has two
members. One is Ms. Rose Gomez. Her term hasn't expired, and he's got a vacant slot, so I believe he's nominating Mr. Casada.
And I second it, Mayor.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 All opposed? I don't have a problem. Aye. Item, the next item, please. Item 7.
Excuse me, Mayor, but there's several commissioners that have vacancies. If I understand that they're probably not ready today, but once you have the names, there is a little application attached to your packet. If you can ask them to fill that out and send it to me so I can put their names on the agenda when it comes back. Appreciate that.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Ben. Item 7.
Item 7, consideration in action to acknowledge Mayor Pat M. Amada Jr. as the Brownsville Public Utilities Board member to the Capital Improvement Advisory Committee.
Okay, the PUB Board unanimously appointed me to the Capital Improvements Advisory Committee. In fact, I was the one that initiated this effort for the impact fee. So out of courtesy, I'm bringing it to the commission. It does not require action, is that right, City Attorney?
I believe it's in the ordinance, Mayor, the way the ordinance is written, that PUB would have a representative, if I'm not mistaken.
So where do you put it on our agenda?
No, I did out of courtesy, but somebody put action here, which they shouldn't have.
So it is or is not an action item?
It's an acknowledgement.
Acknowledgement. It's an acknowledgement.
Action would be to acknowledge PUB's appointment.
Yeah, well, I so move.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
I don't acknowledge PUB's report.
Okay, Mr. Longoria, that's not acknowledged, but we have a motion to acknowledge. Do we have a second?
It's only an acknowledgement.
Okay.
It's already been done.
We have a second. All in favor?
I only have one. I only have Mr. Garza as the motion to acknowledge. Who was the second?
I'll second it.
I thought you made the motion to acknowledge.
The motion, I second. This is cold.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Nay.
Nay.
Make your, raise your hands and nays, please.
Nay.
Nay.
Raise your hand, Mr. Tranny, if it's an A or a yay.
Oh, I'll just go nay.
Okay, nay. It's okay. But it doesn't require action, so whether you acknowledge it or not, it makes no difference. Okay, item 8.
Item 8, consideration and action to appoint one member to the Capital Improvement Advisory Committee.
Okay, this is for the ETJ, is that right?
Yes, Mayor. This member has to reside in the ETJ. You do have a Planning and Zoning Commission member that's serves on that commission as the ETJ representative, Mr. Victor Alvarez.
Okay.
That would be a good candidate if you would like, or if you would have a separate person, that's your discretion.
Okay, does anybody have a problem with Mr. Alvarez?
Well, Mayor, actually I have a problem on a few of them that are already existing. Jim, I believe there was a TML ruling that if you are a member of the kayak, you could only be a member of one of these committees, is that correct? I think we have some members on the kayak that are currently serving on two committees. Do you know if you got that TML ruling?
No, sir, I'm not aware of that. The statute itself provides that the city commission can enact an ordinance which sets certain parameters for people who can serve. We would
have we done that?
Yes, sir, we have. And Ben probably is more familiar with it than I am at this point, but I believe that other than the statute specifying a certain number of the people have to come from real estate or construction, a certain number of people or one representative has to come from the ETJ, I'm not aware of any provision that would prohibit someone who's serving on a different committee.
I think that would he would be excluded if he served on the housing authority.
Right, I think the commission is relating to TML and the state local government code regarding housing authorities.
State local?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Medina, I would ask that you speak louder. I can't hear what you're saying.
Yes, sir.
What I mentioned right now was that I believe Commissioner Camarillo is relating to the fact of the Texas government code regarding housing authorities, which is specific that says that a commissioner cannot be a public officer of the municipality. And I believe Mr. Goza did get a TML ruling on that.
But there's no conflict for Mr. Alvarez to serve here.
There's a conflict with one of the gentlemen, Mr. Galansky, who serves on the housing authority, which you appointed him, and he serves on kayak. So that's my concern. I want to make sure that we're following state law, and he serves on P&Z, and I know who else falls into that bracket. So my concern is...
First of all, we're out of order here. Let's get back on the appointment. That's what's here before. You want to bring that up for discussion, bring it through your attorney here.
Let me ask you something, Camarillo. Did you vote for those guys, for him to be on two of those boards? You did.
Mayor, I mean...
Why are you contradicting? You just... I'd like to apologize to the students from St. Joe that are here.
Out of order. Commissioner...
For all this chaos.
Agassi has the floor.
Stupid what you're doing.
Charles, Commissioner, it's not stupid.
You voted for him twice.
Please, Commissioner, please.
I'm a state law commissioner.
You just want to fight everything.
Not state law. Wait a second. Hey, out of order.
Mayor, can I...
Stop right now. One at a time speaks, please.
Can I speak?
I'll give you the floor. You finish with, say, Mr. Agassi, okay.
Can I speak?
You may speak, no.
Okay, Commissioner, with all due respect, okay, I don't have any ill feelings towards you. On the issue, state law, the state local code was not brought up.
Then why'd you vote for him twice?
Don't debate, just listen to him and then respond.
Why'd you vote for him twice?
Commissioner, I'm asking you to consider this and think that state law has been brought in now. Did I know the state law then? No, I did not. Do you have a problem with that?
Attorney, I think you better inject here, because I think I think people are not well informed here on this issue here. Now, it's up to you.
I have the floor, Mayor.
You may have the floor.
Commissioner Camarillo, I think that what you're thinking of is in the statute regarding the housing authority, it states that no one can be an officer of the city and also serve on the housing authority. And I have prepared a memo on that point, but that would not apply, to my understanding, to the kayak or to the members on the kayak. It would apply to members who would be serving on the housing authority. And
that's why I bring this up.
But that's not the issue right now here before a city attorney.
No, sir, it's not.
Okay, so Mr. Camarillo, if you have a problem with that, why don't you sit down with the attorney privately and go over it, and then if you have something that you want to bring in here, put on the agenda, we can discuss it if you want to do that. Right now, let's focus on the issue that's on the agenda. Now, there's no problem, unless you have a problem personally or for whatever reason.
No personal
I guess
problems.
Mr. Alvarez.
No personal
okay.
problems.
Okay, so then Mr. Alvarez, okay, do you have a problem? Right? That's what's here before. The recommendation was Mr. Alvarez. Do you have a problem?
I don't have a problem.
Okay. Can we have a motion for Mr. Alvarez?
So moved.
I'll second it.
A motion. We have by Mr. Cisneros, Commissioner Cisneros, is seconded by Mr. Troiani. Commissioner Troiani, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Why don't you abstain? Because you don't know.
Shut up.
Okay,
man.
Out of order.
Commissioner.
Out of order. Come on, guys.
You're out of line, Commissioner.
No, I'm not.
You're talking about being personal here. It's obvious.
You didn't know what was going on. Now
it's on the city of Brownsville. Instead of the personalities, okay?
Yeah, but no one's saying, talking about being personal, Mayor. I think those are just...
But I believe Commissioner Camarillo was out of line because that item, what he's talking about is
okay,
not...
Come on, I already said out of order. Let's get back to focus on this. The next item, please.
Item number nine, executive...
Don't make it hard for our city secretary here.
Item number nine, executive session. Item A, discussion pursuant to section 551.071 of the Texas Government Code regarding consultation with the attorney. Item B, discussion pursuant to section 551.071 of the Texas Government Code regarding consultation with an attorney. Item C, discussion pursuant to section 551.072 of the Texas Government Code regarding real property. Item D, discussion pursuant to section 551.071 of the Texas Government Code regarding pending litigation. And item E, discussion pursuant to section 551.074, Title V, of the Texas Government Code concerning the evaluation of the city attorney of the city of Brownsville.
So move we go in executive session.
Second. Motion.
Second.
We have a second by Mr. Troiani. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. And ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for the outburst here. I'm really sorry.
Nerdis.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience, and we will proceed with item 10. City Secretary.
Item 10, public hearing in action to reconsider Class L permit number CL2007-001 to allow a game arcade at 344 Paredes Line Road, Brownsville, Texas.
This is a public hearing. Okay.
Honorable Mayor and City Commission, this item appeared at the last meeting. We just need clarification on that action, please.
We had the public hearing though last time, though.
Yes, we did.
Needs his action, he's still on.
I'm sorry, Mayor. It's just a housekeeping matter. The issue was brought up for a vote to whether or not the facility would be given a permit. The motion was actually made to deny the permit, and then there was a discussion, and when the vote was taken, four members voted against the measure. It was, it's our understanding that what the commission was trying to do was to vote against giving the permit.
No, I think you're wrong here, because the motion was made to deny it, and people voted against denying it.
That's correct. But our understanding was that the will of the commission was to deny the permit.
No, it wasn't.
No, it wasn't.
Well, that was the most, okay. Well, let's put it to a vote.
That's why we brought it tonight, to be sure.
I think it was the exact opposite.
Yeah. Okay.
Then we.
But the motion was made and then erroneously.
We don't need a vote on it if he's clarified now.
No.
Well, yeah, you know, just do it.
We do need to vote on it, because I think there was a misunderstanding by the person who made the motion.
We were not sure in trying to do the minutes what the vote was intended to be.
I'll refresh it for you. Two commissioners voted to deny, but the motion was not brought up to approve, so that's what we need. We're pending the motion to approve.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would move to approve.
I second it.
Okay, a motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Nay.
Okay. Who said nay?
I did.
Somebody? Okay.
Thank you.
I had said nay the last time, so.
Well, thank you for that clarification.
Are you a nay today?
So it passed.
Are you a nay or a yay?
No, it passed. I said nay. Uh-huh. Passed.
Okay.
It's okay.
I just wish you'd vote.
Yes, huh? I have the mayor and Commissioner Camarillo as a nay.
It passed.
She's putting you as a nay. She wants clarification.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah,
it's a nay
for
her and him and Camarillo.
I just have a question. That place is close to, what is it?
All-Star Realty.
All-Star Realty.
No.
Church.
It just clarifies it passed, right?
Yes.
Okay, it passed. The last time you had two nay votes, and this time you have two nay votes.
Number 11.
Okay.
Mayor.
It passed.
I mean, Mr. Goza, it's also a public hearing, so is it going to be open to the public?
We had closed it last time.
We had closed the public hearing.
The hearing was closed.
It's just a vote. You just wanted the vote for clarification, right?
That's right.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
so it's done.
That's done.
Number 11.
Okay.
Item 11, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 2007-1100.44, amending the city code to clarify the relationship between the Capital Improvement Advisory Committee and other entities and dealing with related matters, including $500 penalties.
Honorable Mayor and City Commissioners, we have an ordinance. It's an amendment on the kayak ordinance. Allison from our office will go over the amendment and the proposed ordinance.
This was never.
Good evening. Basically, this ordinance amends a previous ordinance, 2006-1139. It amends some chapters of the Brownsville City Code. It also repeals some parts of Chapter 300. The amendments, I'll summarize. Section 314-20 allows for 10 members of the kayak instead of 7. It also provides that the mayor is to select the kayak chair, but that selection requires approval by a majority vote of the city commission.
Wait a minute. The first time that we did this, the former mayor appointed the chair, okay? And that was it. We were stuck with that. This time, I appointed a temporary chair, and then the committee elected their own chair. Which, what's wrong with that?
In the prior ordinance, Mayor, the Planning and Zoning Commissioner, the Planning and Zoning Commission chair was the chairman of the CIAC.
Oh, okay. Okay. I got you now. Okay.
Uh, 314-21 just covers some things that naturally follow from an increase in CIAC membership. A quorum is now six members, not four. Should the CIAC decide to submit reports or advice as individual reports, 10 are required now instead of seven. Also, it provides that a simple majority vote is required to adopt and enforce CIAC rules instead of a five-vote supermajority. Section 300-26 requires that the definition of body no longer includes CIAC. And Section 329B provides that not only regular but also special members must comply with residing in the city's territorial jurisdiction, except for the extraterritorial representative, and also to comply with laws by statute applicable to members of such boards. 337 provides that the city commission is to adopt rules for CIAC's transaction of business. Previously, that was CIAC's job. Let's see. Sections 321 through 325 are now renumbered to 301 to 305. We reserve former 301 through 325, I'm sorry. And it's too lengthy to make on a PowerPoint slide about, but throughout these sections, the word chapter becomes development code. Development code. And essentially, what that means is these sections provide definitions, code enforcement provisions, amendment procedures, etc., and the gist of the change is that the substance of these sections will apply to the entire development code and not just to those chapters. Also in 301, the phrase article in this chapter becomes chapter in this development code. Section 302B, former 320B, adds a new definition, development code, which is subpart B of part 2 of the city code. Essentially, that is, those are chapters 300 through 338. The repealed sections of the Brownsville City Code include 327E, which provided that the members of the Planning and Zoning Commission also constituted the membership of the CIAC. No longer the case.
Who's requesting all this?
I'm sorry?
Where's this all coming
from? This?
Okay, Commissioner, basically, when you added more members to the CIAC, it sparked that we amend the ordinance appropriately.
Okay.
But this ordinance has been, we've been working closely with Mr. Dick O'Neill, with the PUB attorney, and it was sent to Mr. Goza in his packet. So even as late as this afternoon, we're reviewing, making sure that everything was consistent with the statute and consistent throughout the ordinance with different terminology and CIAC members, et cetera.
But as I explained to Mr. O'Neill, who drafted the ordinance, that's why it was being brought to you for review, because this is your chance to change it, or aside from what 395 the statute requires, then anything else or less you want in there, this is the chance to do that.
Okay.
Are we making these changes tonight, or will they be brought back to us later?
That's at your discretion, Commissioner. If you need more time for us to maybe discuss them further with you, we will do that.
I do.
We're under, okay, that'll be perfect. We're under no time constraints at this time to pass anything. We want to make sure that, this ordinance is developed with everybody's consensus and that everybody understands every section and what we're trying to do.
I'm going to request this from you, if it's okay with the City Commission, that you prepare a workshop for us at our next meeting with the changes that are to occur so that they're specific and that you draft them in action mode, in action items, so that we can be clear as to the specifics that are being changed and that they be specific as to the individual items that are being changed, if the commission is fine with it.
I would need a motion to table this.
I so move.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mr. Garza, seconded by Commissioner Longoria. All in favor of the table?
Aye.
Close public hearing?
We need to close public hearing?
No, we're tabling it.
Continuance on...
We're tabling it. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Item 12.
Item 12, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2007-604-CU, allowing a conditional use permit to sell on-premise alcohol for Lot 1 and east half of Block 140-A out of Stillman Extension and addition to the City of Brownsville at Jaimito's Restaurant located near West Elizabeth Street and Central Boulevard.
Honorable Mayor and City Commission, this is the property sitting in red. This is an existing establishment, a restaurant. The Planning and Zoning Commission voted to allow, they applied for mixed drinks, beer and wine to be sold with their meals. The Planning and Zoning Commission set some conditions of only beer and wine to be sold with their meals and had some conditions regarding the hours of operation for the beer and wine. And
that was why? Are they close to a school? Are they close to something?
They're right next, Commissioner, across the street. Across the street from the establishment is a church, Iglesia Damasco. And the Planning and Zoning Commission voted to have their hours of operation between 12 noon and 9 p.m.
The public
for the selling of alcohol.
For the sale of alcohol.
Yes, sir. Mr. Mayor, church has wine.
And I would just make an observation that the reason that this was is being presented to you as a special use permit is because the ordinance would not allow the sale of alcohol that close to the church. So
that's correct. So there are
to do it without special permission.
Right.
And I would also point out, just as a matter of legal precedent, that if you do make an exception once, then certainly their argument is there in the future, should someone else want to make the same argument.
Because once you allow them to sell alcohol, spirits, then they could turn it on over to a nightclub if they wanted to, right?
Well, it'd be limited to the zone and to the restrictions that are being placed on it, but they would be able to sell beer and wine within the prohibited proximity to the church. And that would be my concern as the attorney, is that...
Is anybody here from the church opposing this?
So move to close public hearing.
I think you have some area residents
I must
that...
I want to speak. This is a public hearing. Mr. Kent, you want to speak or somebody? Okay. This is a public hearing, please.
Mr. Mayor, Commissioners, my name is Craig Timmer. I live at 1202 West Washington here in Brownsville. I'm here as a representative of the West Brownsville Neighborhood Association to ask that you deny the application by Jaimito's Restaurant for a conditional use as a wet restaurant. Foremost in your consideration, as you've already briefly discussed, is the application of City Ordinance Number 2005-235.66, Chapter 348. That document prohibits alcohol to be sold within 200 feet of a church or a residence. Jaimito's Restaurant is nearer than 200 feet, in fact it's just across the street from Templo Damasco Church, and is directly across the alley from two residences on Levy Street. If you allow this variation from the ordinance, how will any other church, school, or residence feel protected from the establishment of any other restaurant wanting to serve alcohol? In addition, we feel that as parking for this establishment is already problematic, it would be even worse with an increased customer flow if alcohol was allowed to be served. And so we respectfully request that you deny this application.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Anybody else want to speak against it?
Gentlemen, my name is John Kinch. I live within 200 feet of the establishment, and I also live directly behind Amelia's restaurant, which is the next corner up. My concern is that if Jaimito's gets a permission, why can't Amelia's? And the difference with Amelia's is that's in my backyard. And we already have overloaded congestion on the street with on-street parking. They can't contain their people in their own parking lot. They can't keep them in the church's parking lot and across the street. It's a very popular restaurant. They would have every right in the world to ask for this if you give it to Jaimito's. And then one more block up is Bougainvillea's restaurant, which again, it's the same situation, right adjacent to a residential, and there are other churches, believe it or not, in the different establishments across the street. So I just think you're opening a whole big can of worms. If you give it to one, you know, why can't you give it to the property next to St. Mary's? Why can't you give it to Good Shepherd out by Home Depot? Why can't you give it anybody who wants to open a restaurant near a residential, near a church? There's no reason to have the ordinance. And I understand that on the application tonight, you have item number 14, which is a similar application for the same excuse or conditional use.
Thank you, Mr. Kinch.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Can I have a motion to close public hearing?
Move.
Motion by Commissioner Longoria, second by Commissioner Garza. All in favor to close public hearing?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. This is an action item. Can I have a motion to accept or deny?
Move to deny.
What is the wishes?
Second.
Motion to deny by Commissioner Camarillo, seconded by Commissioner Troiani. To deny. Is it clear, Ben?
Yes.
Okay. We're voting to deny. All in favor to deny?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Nay.
Nay.
Okay. You got two nays that would like to give the permit, okay? Next item, please.
Item 13, public hearing and action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2007-605-CU, allowing a conditional use permit to sell off-premise alcohol for lot 18, block 1 out of Isla de Palma subdivision, section 4, located near Esperanza and Southmost Road.
Honorable Mayor and City Commission, The property stated in red, but right here.
That's the subject?
That's the subject, yes, sir. In this particular case, the Planning and Zoning Board announced to recommend approval. This is for a wet store.
For what?
This is a wet store. This would be a drive-through where people drive their vehicle into the building.
It's a beer barn.
Yeah, something like that. And
Mayor, I'm
sorry. This is a public hearing?
Public hearing.
Only to interject that I've not seen before approval of this sort of thing from the Planning and Zoning Commission. I don't know if there's been a change of philosophy on their part.
There has. There were the two, the La Cueva establishments, one on Milpa Verde, one on Central, and there's another one on Billy Mitchell. We've done three.
I wasn't aware that those had been approved but unanimously by
P&Z. We've done three.
Stand corrected. I don't know. It's maybe they're just looking at it.
Okay, this is a public hearing. Is there anyone in favor or against it? Who wants to speak?
Ben, is it within the 200?
The 200. As you can see, Commissioner, that there's a single-family residential right behind it. It's the adjacent property.
Right, but the church, the school, that's not within the 200?
No.
Okay.
I would move to close public hearing.
No, wait a second. Do you want to speak? No. Do you want to speak?
Second. Do you want to speak back there?
You want to speak? This is a public hearing. You got to speak out in order to be heard here.
Okay. I just wanted to correct you. It's not a wet, what was it that you called it?
Like a beer barn, drive-through?
No.
What is it going to be?
It's going to be a convenience store.
Okay.
You know, we're going to have just basically everything.
But your client can drive through?
Yeah.
It's just barn is a technical term.
Oh, okay.
It's a convenience store. Yeah, okay, so
the drive-through convenience store.
But people cannot drink on the premises.
No.
Okay.
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anybody from the neighborhood here opposing it?
Move to close.
Okay, we have a motion to close by Commissioner Atkinson, seconded by Commissioner Longoria. All in favor to close public hearing?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Approve.
Second.
A motion by Commissioner Longoria, seconded by Commissioner Atkinson to approve. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Next item, please.
Item 14, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 235-2007-606-CU, allowing a conditional use permit to sell on-premise alcohol for lots 5 and 6, block FF, out of Brownsville Land and Improvement Company, located near Central Boulevard and North Korea Streets.
Honorable Mayor and City Commissioners, this is Central Boulevard here, this is Korea. The library is in this part of the map, and then you have a new golf teen,
driving range.
Driving range here, and this is a proposed site. And this proposed site, they want to have a wet restaurant and bar. The applicant did submit his proposed hours of operation.
Who's the applicant?
The applicant in the application is listed as the Guzman Ramos and, like you said, Arminia Ramos, as the representing agents for the applicant.
Is that the one right across from Tony Romas? Is that the driver?
Tony Romas is
the golf place, the new
Tony Romas driving is right
range?
Here.
Yeah. It is?
Oh. Tony Romas is over here, Commissioner.
It's,
And here's the driving range, and here's the vacant wooded area, and that's, and then you have some apartments. You have Kenmont School around here.
School.
It's right.
School is about, I guess from the nearest corner would be about 250 feet.
What school is that?
Kenmont.
Kenmont.
It's a preschool.
So there's nothing within 200 feet that would prohibit this from being approved?
Well, such as a school or a church,
yeah.
You do have an apartment complex, you have commercial apartments.
Where HEB's at?
HEB
no,
further south.
No, you're way off.
No, Commissioner, if you come in from the expressway, you're going to have Tony Roma's, Denny's, and then you come in
Media
Luna Drive, and then you have the little golf driving range,
yeah.
The new one, right across the street, Korea. That would be the site. It's
okay.
Green space, right? It's green trees on it. Okay. They would have, let me tell you a bit about the application. In the restaurant and bar and grill, their hours of operation would be 11 a.m. to 2 a.m. The bar and lounge, 6 p.m. to 2 a.m. And the wet bar from 4 p.m. to 2 a.m.
Okay, is there anybody here from the neighborhood opposing it? Is there anybody here opposing it?
Move to close.
Move to close by Commissioner Atkinson, second by Commissioner Longoria. All in favor to close?
Commissioner Garza.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Garza. All in favor to close?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. This is an action item.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion to approve by Commissioner Atkinson, seconded by Commissioner Longoria. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Item 15.
Item 15, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 2007-235.70 to consider the repeal of the 051 overlay district from approximately 17.176 acres out of a 200.34 acre tract known as the Santander town site of Barreras Gardens tract in share one of Espiritu Santo grant.
Honorable Mayor,
read them together.
I would ask if the city secretary can read the call on 16, 17, and 18.
Wait. Everybody's trying to say, what do you have to say?
Mayor, I'm asking for permission.
If
the city secretary.
15, 16, 17, and 18, they're all related.
Is that your wish?
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am. Read 15, 16, and 17.
Item 16, public hearing in action on first reading of ordinance number 2007-235.71 to consider the repeal of the 051 overlay district from approximately 59.66 acres out of the 200.34 .34-acre tract known as the Santander Townsite of Barrera Gardens Tract and share one of the Espiritu Santo grant. Item 17, public hearing and action on first reading of ordinance number 2007-235.72 to consider the repeal of the 051 overlay district from approximately 72.34 acres out of a 200.34-acre tract known as the Santander Townsite of Barrera Gardens Tract and share one of Espiritu Santo grant. Item 18, public hearing and action on first reading of ordinance number 2007-235.73 to consider the repeal of the 051 overlay district from approximately 5.845 acres out of a 200.34-acre tract known as the Santander Townsite of Barrera Gardens Tract and share one of Espiritu Santo grant.
Honorable okay. Mayor and City Commissioners, this is the area in, or subdivision known as Rancho Sampatico. When the developer came before us, we placed the 051 overlay district, which is a historical, the tourist corridor overlay on the whole subdivision. Working with the developer, this overlay is more pertinent to historical districts where the speed limit is much less. This is 281, the speed limit is higher. There's conflicts with the type of signage, with the height of signage, and other conditions regarding green space. So what we are doing is removing at this time that overlay, and then we will come back with you with a different overlay that will protect this corridor. And this is something that the developer also wishes to have done.
But wasn't the overlay was done specifically to keep some sort of uniformity and continuity in the area?
Yes, Commissioner, but since we only place this overlay on the subdivision, the surrounding properties do not have the same protection. So we want to come back and impose a different overlay that comes further south along 281 down into the city limits of Brownsville.
Ben, it should be noted also to the developer, the applicant, that they had no idea that such an overlay was being placed when it was being passed by the city commission.
Well, I think we knew that there was an overlay, but it just not the full extent of it regarding the landscaping and the type of signage, the fine details.
But I mean, in terms of the package,
let's talk one at a time. Are you finished, Mr. Cardi?
No, one more comment. In terms of the packet that the applicant submitted, no overlay, there was no issues with that. And I think that's the defining moment where, you know, when it all got done and all of a sudden here's this overlay, you know, what do you do? So that's my point that I want to bring up. That's why we're at this point right now.
Wouldn't it make more sense to have a plan in place before you start?
Mr. Agus is next.
Oh, excuse me. Let Mr. Agus go.
Yeah.
Be recognized,
yes, Mr. Agus.
Mr. Agus, you want to be recognized?
Is that recommendation?
Yes, Commissioner.
Based on what? What's going to come out of this?
What's going to come out, Commissioner, we have determined that the 051, as it is today, it's not pertinent to the expressway or this 281 because the speed limit is higher. It requires much smaller signs that you won't be able to read driving at 55 miles an hour. There's also green space that you have to landscape 50% of your front yard, to allow more green space. But it will allow parking, but it's the ordinance is not very clear. And then to go to Mr. Triani's, we do have a land use plan for this quadrant of the community. It's a brand new plan. But we want to do, removing this does go against that plan, but what we want to do is come back with a more clear, more defined overlay that goes along with the speed limit of 281. So yes, my recommendation is to delete this now, even though it's a little bit in conflict with that plan that we have, but we'll come back with a better overlay.
Okay.
Well, why wouldn't we just come back with the new overlay and so we could substitute it instead of leaving it open where somebody could do something that would be adverse to what our proposal is?
Yes, that's a good point. But at this point, the developer feels that it's burdensome for her to sell lots, and she has enough covenants in her subdivision that will protect what we want to do. but we will, as fast as we can, come back to you with that overlay. But yes, you're correct. A switcheroo or a switch would be
Ben,
would be better.
But is this a residential?
It's a residential with commercial lots fronting 281.
Commercial lots fronting. But the lady, just clear it one more time, the lady was, the developer, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Was not aware of the 051.
Well, I think she didn't know that there was an overlay. But that the different fine conditions that are placed on regarding signage.
Okay.
And
let's do this. Robert, can you get her a bigger sign? Not a small sign? Can you do it to where she's got a big sign that says, you got to go, I mean, I have a 20 at my house and people go 55. You know?
State highway
has to be done through the state, but we can request it through the state.
P&Z didn't even know of the overlay. They didn't even know, so.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Paula LeGros, and this is a property that was in my family since 1947, and it has been our intent to put together a very nice development in the area. I don't know if you all know about it, Rancho Simpatico. We're in the process of doing a large park donation. We're trying to build a nice community that's good for people to live in. It's the kind of community that my children, I'd be proud to raise my own children in, and yet to remain affordable for the community that's appropriate for that area.
Ma'am,
yes.
Would you just, are you the, you came to us about a year ago?
Yes, sir.
With the property over by 803?
It's 1421 and 281.
Okay,
so this
I'm sorry.
The only thing I have.
Okay.
This is it. This is my
sorry.
Family farm right here.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And so we did talk about, we went to planning and zoning and talked about, is there different ways that we can make the zoning work appropriately for our area? And the commercial zoning that we have is what's called 4C, which is retail. So it eliminates the outdoor car lots. It eliminates the tire stores and the things that aren't considered as appropriate for the main corridors coming into the city. So we're very supportive of that. We looked at the 051 overlay and realized that it was prohibitive in terms of we're trying to sell commercial lots and fund the project, and that this would be unfair to us because the person next door would have an appropriate sign, and somebody who wants to put a gas station in would have a sign about this tall. So there's not, it doesn't allow for appropriate signage along 281. So we did not, when we did our zoning request, we did not request it. The master plan that was approved for the area did not have the 051 overlay on it. When, after it was all said and done and I got the letter in the mail and suddenly the 051 overlay was there, it was a big surprise to us. And we got this letter back in June of 2006.
Ben, one more question. If she's going to have frontage 281 commercial, and mind you, you're very big on specific uses on 281. Wouldn't you just be able to take care of this with your famous specific uses on 281?
I would say famous, but it could. I mean, there could be an avenue for somebody to have a commercial entity or commercial business on 281 with conditions, and that's what the special use is a conditional permit. In this particular case, there were public hearings held on this overlay and was imposed by this commission and the Planning and Zoning Commission. But, you know,
Commissioner Camarillo just said that Planning and Zoning was not aware of the 051 in this area.
No, we followed the ordinance and it was advertised and it went through P&Z and we had public hearings. So
the girl was at the P&Z and
well, you see, but the thing is that you know, maybe she knew there was an overlay, but not the fine details of that overlay. And we know that when you talk about 50% of landscape and on different lots, I mean, it's confusing for the ordinary person. But in this case, what we're trying to do tonight is to remove the overlay, which will come back with you with an overlay that's more appropriate to the speeds of 281.
But isn't that the same overlay that you have on 511 out towards the battlefield?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Which and 511, the speed limit is over 55.
That's correct. But that's what we're trying to do is to protect it. That overlay is there to protect the national battlefield, the battle site. So yes, you would have monument signs on 511.
Right, and this is exact. And 281 once again is the same. Not necessarily has the same destination point,
that's
but
correct.
It's the same type of.
But that's what we were trying to do. But the developer, and working with the developer, we understand that a Circle K, for example, may not have a pylon sign. It will have a monument sign. So what we're trying to do is rectify that, come to some agreement, some consensus as to, you know, those amenities, those signs, those landscaping that will be appropriate to 281. So we will come back with an ordinance, with an overlay for 281. If you wish so, we can.
How long will it take?
It would take us about 60 days, the max. Commissioner, we have already started working on this overlay, and it's just a matter of putting it before P&Z, advertising it appropriately, and having the public hearings. See, all these overlays, wherever they're placed, we have public hearings, and you're the ones that place them. It's not staff by themselves. They have to come before this body.
You know, we came, our intent in this whole development was to do something nice, and we requested the zoning, and I'm not a professional developer. I've done building construction. I've put together a team that's working for us. We worked with the city. We're working with city parks, and it's been a very good faith effort. In this particular case, I don't know that I was at those meetings where all of a sudden the 051 was being put on. It was specifically not requested, so I had to pay for the zoning. I specifically requested certain zoning, and it was a surprise to me when this letter came. When that happened in June of 06, we did go back and say, there was a mistake, something happened. I've got a zoning ordinance, I requested it, it was already approved as a master plan. I was surprised that there was any issue or problem or change. It was already approved in the master plan. And they said, well, we're going to change the ordinance. That was in June of 2006. About a month or two ago, I finally went to planning and zoning, and they were kind of surprised. They didn't know anything about it, and at that time there was absolutely no effort being made to do this overlay. So we now have lots to sell, and because I'm doing a project that's nice, the person next to me can put in the used car lot, can have a big sign, and the person who's going to buy my lot will say, no, thank you, because you want it to do something nice, and we can't have a sign. We can't. It's a 55-mile-an-hour road, so we're being penalized when we're trying to do the right thing. So I feel it's not fair. We're being unfairly penalized. And it was not, and I had to pay for the zoning. It wasn't like an action from the city that said, well, we're going to do the zoning because it's the best for the city. It's just pocketed. The person right next door can have a large sign, a car lot. We have eliminated those types of things. We've gone to 4C, which is retail, which is what the city wanted in terms of the zoning for the area. So we have made a lot of efforts in that regard. This is just penalizing our sales. So for all of our efforts, I'm now going to be penalized with lower sales, and the person's going to buy the lot next to ours, not ours.
Didn't you donate land to the city or something like that?
Yes, I did. Yeah, park. We donated about, well, we're in the process. It's a whole dance you do with the grants, but there's a grant application we're donating. It's about 40 or 50 acres of parkland.
That hasn't happened?
No, because it's a long story, but the city master plan for the parks was never completed, so we couldn't put the application in for our grant. That's now. I just talked to Skip today.
So what happens if it doesn't? What happens if you don't get the grant?
They'll look for other forms of funding. There's HUD funding. There's other funding. However, right now, because of the project, there's no parks in the area. Because of the demographics of the area, it has very high points. Although grant writers who do this professionally feel that our project will definitely be a successful project for a $500,000 grant.
So it's not donated to the city right now?
Right. It's not right now. You can't donate it prior to writing the grant. You have to... The grant wants matching funds, and the matching fund is the land donation. So it's set up to do the donation, but the grant officially goes in, as I understand it now, the next grant opportunity. We've missed two cycles because the city didn't have their master plan ready. The master plan is supposed to be ready in November. The next cycle is April, and the funding should come in August of next year, at which point we'll start actually donate the land, and the city will then construct the parks, which that will be the beginning of the seed money to begin the project.
Well, let me ask you something, and that's going to be inside the subdivision.
It's inside the subdivision. I can...
Okay, are you going to charge
no,
a PID tax?
No, actually, this park's going to be open to, if I'm not mistaken, Ms. LeGros, it's going to be open to everybody in the area. This is a, and this is back when Mayor Trevino was here. Again, Ms. LeGros came with her people to talk about this development. This is a critical development to Brownsville. And what she wants to do with Skip, and I you know, advise everybody to sit down with Skip and when Ms. LeGros is down here again, to talk about it, because I went out there with them about last month, and we went to go see the track land that they had by the levee out there. I'd never been out there in my life, and you could just see what, in a, hopefully in a couple of months or years, what will be out there for that community, but for, again, all neighboring areas. So this is a development that Ms. LeGros has been spearheading, and I appreciate that. It has a lot of historical and family value to you, so I recognize that, and I think that's great. So I would advise everybody to get with Skip and Ms. LeGros.
It's walking distance to San Pedro. They don't have parks over there. The school, it's actually walking distance from the school. It's got trails where the kids can ride safely off the sidewalks and get to the parks. It's a project that the whole community, it has trail connectors that go to other developments that are planned in the area and exist in the area. So it's really a community area. When we had the meetings, other meetings, people come up to me in the neighborhood and want to hear about it and bring their kids. And so it is a neighborhood park system.
Mayor,
Mayor, before we close or before we continue this, I'd ask that maybe at the next city commission meeting that Mr. Skip Keller bring us an update as to where we are in our master plan for the parks so that we can get to on to business.
Good point.
May I? Good evening. Mayor, commissioners, I think it is about time that we think about Brownsville and the needs that we have in Brownsville. And I think this development will bring a lot of needed taxes, a lot of needed income that we need in our city. I think this is a beautiful plan. I heard what is going on. I think that we should put Brownsville first. And if they're not asking to sell beer, liquor, or bars or nothing, are they asking to build something beautiful for Brownsville? Let's research it. Please do not deny this permit. If you need to wait and issue some kind of order that you rethink it or it goes back to planning and zoning, and let's give these people an opportunity to bring more income to the city of Brownsville and maybe more jobs. Thank you very much.
Mayor, with that,
Mr. Fuentes, this is
close.
A public hearing. Can we have a motion to close it?
I still move.
A motion by Commissioner Camarillo, seconded by Commissioner Atkinson. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries to close. This is an action item. This is on all these items that
Read out. Move to repeal 15, 16, 17, and 18.
Second. I had a motion.
I'll second it.
Well, I had moved to approve, but you're not, right?
Well, this is to repeal, to repeal. Take off the overlay.
Okay. We have a motion to repeal by Commissioner Camarillo, second by Commissioner Cisneros, to repeal. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Good luck. Next item, please.
Item 19, consideration in action on resolution number 2007-056. Authorizing and approving the Brownsville Matamoros Weir and Reservoir Project as a Secure Fence Act project to secure the southern United States border.
The resolution is self-explanatory, but you can read it. City Secretary, please.
A resolution of the City Commission of the City of Brownsville, Texas, authorizing and approving the Brownsville Matamoros Weir and Reservoir Project as a Secure Fence Act project to secure the southern United States border. Whereas the City of Brownsville, Texas and the Brownsville Public Utilities Board propose to construct a weir and reservoir that will be located on the Rio Grande approximately 8 miles downstream of the Gateway Bridge in Brownsville, and as a conservation project to recapture river water for municipal use. And whereas the reservoir created by the project will be located within the existing banks of the Rio Grande on an average width of 110 feet at the maximum water elevation of 26 feet above mean sea level along 42 river miles, and whereas on October 26, 2006, President George W. Bush signed the Secure Fence Act authorizing the construction of hundreds of miles of fencing along the border with Mexico, including the Brownsville, Texas sector, in an important step to control the southern border, and whereas the federal funding for border security has more than doubled from $4.6 billion in 2001 to $10.4 billion in 2007, and whereas the Brownsville-Matamoros Weir and Reservoir Project provides for the strategy outlined in the Secure Fence Act and serves the same purpose as the fence by forming a natural physical barrier to secure the border, replacing the need to use fencing along the reservoir, now therefore be it resolved by the City Commission of the City of Brownsville that the City of Brownsville hereby expresses support for the construction and federal funding of the Brownsville-Matamoros Weir and Reservoir Project as an infrastructure project that meets the strategy for comprehensive immigration reform for the U.S. and the Secure Fence Act.
Would approve.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Atkinson, second by Commissioner Garza. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Item 20.
Item 20, consideration and action regarding the moratorium on animal euthanasia and overcrowding at the Brownsville Animal Shelter.
Mayor, members of the City Commission, presently our animal shelter that we have right now, we have room for 62 dogs, 45 cats, and 12 contained areas for animals that may be diseased. For a town our size, we'll probably have to consider plans for expansion. Substantial progress has been made. We're installing some more equipment. We have more adoptions, but I don't know that we'll be able to maintain this. However, we now have a full-time vet on staff, and the full-time vet has corrected a lot of issues that we had come up. The clinic itself is just about done. I figure in another month it will be fully operational. That's what staff is telling us, and that's what we're seeing. It's really coming out pretty nice. There's going to be fencing put in outside for the park system that it'll have there next to the pound itself or to the shelter. But basically, we're still faced with the same issues. We need to have more adoptions. We need to be more careful with our pets. That presently is where we're at. The euthanasias, is being kept in check right now.
Okay,
Mr. President, well.
Mr. Ayala, so what do you oppose? What are you saying that we do? Continue the euthanizing of animals? You know, when that came before the City Commission, we saw that policy or whatever enacted, and it's put us, you know, in violation of state law. We had a lot of issues. I'm not sure that was the best policy. Not real much discussion to take place on better ways and means to address that issue. I get emails from different organizations stating that, you know, at one point we could probably get to euthanizing in this community, but not right now. As you said, the clinic is so important that we kind of do that spayed and neutering. We got to control our animal population. We're years behind probably from doing that. I know the group in place by the mayor's, it's working, you know, so I guess I want to hear, like, what do you think we need to be doing? And I'm not sure if continuing the euthanizing is the sole solution.
Well, you're probably correct. The state has come down and told us that we needed to correct some problems, and right now they're in check. The animal shelter is ready for inspection, and it should have cleared all the issues that the State Department had, the people that correct these things, that check these things, come down. So when they come down, we should be well in compliance with their issues.
So is it
what you're asking is that if we're close, I think we have a long ways to go in respects to the size of our town.
Right.
Probably the animals, we have the largest animal shelter in the valley, as opposed to the people.
Are you asking, did the moratorium end already?
Moratorium already ended the 28th.
So this is asking to continue the moratorium?
This is what the commission has to consider. In comparison with McAllen has a capacity over 300 pets. Brownsville has a capacity for 62 pets. Just by the design of the capacity, the local dog pound is a slaughterhouse. That's what it is. It's a slaughterhouse. And I think Joe will agree with that, and so will the assistant city manager. We have euthanized, even under the moratorium, about 1,000 pets. In spite of all the efforts that we have made by volunteers, and which have been substantial, we made a lot of progress in adopting pets out, educating the public. We euthanized 1,000 pets that were sick, not sick to where they could not be cured with treatment, but just sick, which made it unadoptable. And therefore, they were sacrificed and slaughtered. 1,000 pets in the 90 days moratorium was a result of that. We now have an animal clinic that's being finished. We now have a vet that's there full time. We now have a structured effort to adopt pets out. We stopped the flea market sales and the street corner sales, which brings to control the illegal breeding, and we need to do more. But the problem is here the lack of space. If we don't do anything to address the lack of space, we will continue to be a slaughterhouse. And like I said, there the dog pound. Laguna Vista has more capacity than Brownsville, and it's a little small community. McAllen has a capacity of over 300, and it's a small community in Brownsville. So the answer here you have, each one of us have here, are we going to do something about it, or are we going to sit by and give a lip service and not do nothing about it?
Let me ask Josh, can you come up?
Let me ask you, Yala, we euthanized 1,000?
Approximately.
1,000 animals?
That was the last count.
1,000?
But that was dogs and cats, or was it including possums, raccoons?
Mostly pets, domesticated pets, one or two.
Okay, how many domesticated pets were killed?
Well, that's why I got Josh. Ask him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hey, Josh.
Good evening, Mayor, Commissioners. We pretty much euthanize all animals that come to the shelter when there's no more space, including possums, snakes, dogs, and cats.
But how many snakes and dogs and cats have you euthanized?
How many domestic animals?
Domesticated animals at this moment, only if they're ill or sick.
Do you have a number?
Not at this moment.
But the majority has been domesticated pets, not snakes, possums, or raccoons.
Yeah, the number, majority of animals, yes, they're domesticated animals.
In other words, you don't even make 1% of the 1,000 as snakes, possums, and all that. You don't even make 1%.
No, sir. Unfortunately, I don't have the numbers with me right now, but...
Let me ask you something.
Now we have a vet...
This moratorium.
Yes.
Is it going to burden the city anymore to keep this moratorium, or
based on based on the size of our animal shelter, yes, it is. And we have a vet now that makes a decision as to...
That was my question.
...as to the animals.
The
issue we are trying to address here is, should
space.
We enlarge our animal shelter?
So that isn't what it says here. So are we voting? I just want to make sure what we're voting on. Are we voting to expand the animal shelter?
No.
Are we voting to keep the moratorium going? I just want to be clear on what we're doing here.
And I have a question, too. Are we sending any animals to San Benito or Harlingen, or are we having to pay for that? Well, we don't have room for them?
No, what it is, there's rescue organizations that adopt pets out from all over the place in helping us trying to maintain a no-kill shelter. That's what it is. It's volunteers working together to find homes for our pets.
Again,
the issue here is, do you all want to continue with the moratorium, which has been, in essence, do not kill the healthy pets, but you do have to sacrifice the unhealthy pets. And understandably so, because we don't have the space. That's one of the issues. The other issue is, do we want to continue ignoring the fact that we don't have sufficient space for a city this
size?
So
we're voting on two things.
Yeah. Josh, do we receive state funds from the state regarding the conditions of our animal shelter?
No.
Or is it just a report card, A, B, or C, your F?
Pretty much what depending on the conditions, they'll put us on probation before they suspend our license.
And probation means what? What can they tell us? You're on probation. What do we do? What can they do to us?
Right now, they're giving us already a time frame to correct the problems.
They specify the reasons why we're on probation, well, and they give us a certain amount of time to correct those.
And if we don't correct them?
Well, they'll
because
close us down.
We can't
they'll
maintain.
Close the possibility of closing the shelter.
They'll close the shelter down.
So one of the recommendations was to expand the dog shelter, right? Yes or no? Right?
Whose recommendation?
This animal shelter is relatively new, and the clinic hasn't been finished, and that's going to be brand new. So when it was built, we're saying that it was not built to the size of our community, maybe. Now, if you want to expand it, we'll have to come back with numbers. The expansion of the animal shelter is going to be very expensive if it's built to the same standard as a current animal shelter.
You know,
and I wouldn't
like
worry,
have the discussion
and I
with
wouldn't worry
the animal
about the
shelter. Mayor, I think, you know, the animal shelter committee was in place to oversee this so they could advise the commission, you know what, you need to build a bigger shelter, build one, yes or no, and come to us and say, point blank, this is what we need. But what is the animal shelter committee saying? I don't know. We haven't met. So, therefore, we should be meeting within the next week or 2 weeks to say, you know what, we're going to tell the commission this is what we need to do because, you know what, this is what we have, X, Y, and Z. But we don't have that. All we have here is, well, what do you think? I mean, what do you mean?
Commissioner, it doesn't take a neurosurgeon to figure it out that we don't have the capacity. I would say, or a rocket scientist, I would say give direction to the city manager to come up with a plan to expand to a capacity comparable to our community so he can bring some numbers over here. Because, I mean, anybody can tell you 62 is not enough for a city the size of Brownsville. I mean, anybody can tell you that.
Well, you know,
that's why we're at capacity. We were at capacity, Josh, before I was elected mayor, right? And we're at capacity now.
We've been in behind in shelter construction for the past 10 years. We've asked to increase the shelter capacity for the past 10 years, but unfortunately, funding has not been in place.
Exactly right.
If you compare the shelters, we have the best shelter south of Austin, San Antonio.
And I brought this up during the budget process. I would recommend if the commission wants to address this problem realistically, just direct the city manager, bring us some numbers as to what, not up to the standards of what we built the animal shelter, because I think it was overbuilt for an animal shelter. It looks nice, but it doesn't serve the purpose. I'd rather have something that serves a purpose at less cost than what we have now. Because the idea is to pick up pets, be able to handle the complaints, pick up pets, be able to keep them long enough to try and adopt them out, okay, and have the vet work with them also.
Mayor, I don't want to be caught in the situation.
You want to say something, city manager?
Well, obviously some of the material that's utilized to build an animal shelter is expensive in itself, and we can't just use normal sheetrock, et cetera.
No, I understand that.
It's special materials that really accelerate the cost.
I understand.
Do we have the money to pay for it?
You would have to get the money from...
Reserves?
Yeah.
Mayor, I just don't want to be caught in a situation where the state's going to say you're going to shut down because you have the moratorium in place. And
then don't
if we can build the shelter in 3 months or 5 months and to avoid that, well, then let's look at that and let's do it. But until we really know, you know, how can we continue with the moratorium and face more sanctions by the state?
We don't have
that. Ultimately is making us look bad.
The moratorium has
expired.
Is
there anybody here from the Lower Valley Humane Society? Is there anybody here from the Lower Valley Humane Society?
No.
No, but we did have a letter from them supporting that we do away with the moratorium.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I agree with that.
Yeah, right now.
Okay, well, then do away with the moratorium if that's what you wish is.
And then ask the city manager to come up with some figures and see what we can do. We have to dig and...
You can help solve the issue by directing the city manager, and I'll repeat again, to go back and come up with some plans to... expand the shelter to the capacity that it should be for a community this size. That is within your power if you want that. If you don't want that, make it known. Don't do anything. Do you ignore the problem?
Well, I'm in favor of that.
The ball's in your court.
I'd make a motion to do away with the moratorium.
Okay, you have a motion to do away with the moratorium. Is there anything about directing the city manager to look into expanding the animal shelter complex.
I would ask that if the city manager has time and him and our financial director get together, and if there is some money available, that we look into it. We need to start looking at street guys.
Yeah.
Also.
So and then you don't want to address it, you just want the moratorium.
I want to do away with the moratorium.
Okay. We have a motion to, well, you don't even have to put a motion because the moratorium has already been done away with.
It's an action item.
Okay. Is there anything else?
Second.
Anything else? Okay. There's a motion by Commissioner Longoria to do away with the moratorium.
You said we'd have to take action, right?
It's an action item, it says. Okay. Who seconds it?
But it's already done.
Second.
It's an action item.
Section by Commissioner Camarillo?
Cisneros.
I'm sorry. Commissioner Cisneros. All in favor to do away with the moratorium?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. All opposed? Nay.
Nay.
Okay. Two nays, City Secretary, Mr. Atkinson, myself. Item 21.
It's okay.
Item 21.
It's good for people to know where we stand.
Item 21, consideration and action on resolution number 2007-055 to authorize the closing of Cosmos Boulevard for the 8th annual Veterans Day Parade to be held on Saturday, November the 10th, 2007.
Mayor, members of City Commission, good evening. This is basically a resolution supporting our application to TxDOT to seek permission to close Southmost Boulevard for the Veterans Day Parade on November the 10th.
Move to approve.
Second.
Second.
A motion by Commissioner Longoria, second by Commissioner Atkinson. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Next item, please.
Item 22, consideration and action to donate a surplus forfeited 1990 Chevrolet pickup truck to the University of Texas at Brownsville and Texas Southmost College Biological Services Department.
The UTBTSC Biological Services Department is making a request for us to donate this vehicle. This vehicle was scheduled to go on the auction block, being that it's not cost effective for us to maintain this vehicle anymore.
But correct me if I'm wrong, Chief.
Yes, sir.
Is it against the law to give city property away?
Not as long as it's approved by the commission.
Let me ask you something.
As long as it's approved by the commission.
I'm sorry. As long as we do, it's okay with us?
If you all approve it, that's why it's before you all.
Let me ask you something. I've been in a car with Carlos Lastra, city engineer, in a 1990 Jeep that he drives around. It's in good shape. And I've also known there's a need in the city for trucks. Are we not offering to some of our departments first before we give it to...
No, sir, and we're not because it's not cost effective for us to maintain.
We'll give it to the city.
The fleet The fleet maintenance provider, TCOM, that a contract that we have with the fleet maintenance provider for the city, recommends that any vehicles that are at least 5 years or older be considered to, you know, to do away with, especially with the amount of mileage that this vehicle has. We're talking about...
Does it work good?
Yeah, it works okay, but it's not cost-effective for the city to maintain.
City or the city PD?
The city, period. It costs the city, I mean...
How does he have a 1990 Jeep and it works good and...
His choice.
Is it his choice to drive a...
If Carlos wants to purchase... I'm sorry, Chief.
Right.
If Carlos Lastra wants to purchase a vehicle, he gets it out of his budget. He obviously has been saving money on his budget by driving around the vehicle that he does. He prefers that his guys have the new vehicle, and he drives around a 1990 by choice. The chief wants to do away because TCOM can't handle this vehicle. It's costing too much money. So we have a choice. Somebody requested
costing
it.
Money because of the maintenance of it, or what?
What he refers to as the city is it's a police vehicle, but it goes to TCOM.
TCOM is our fleet maintenance provider for the city.
Could we use it at the city, Charlie, or no?
Well, this specific vehicle, no.
Why?
Because Lastra's got a Cadillac compared to this.
How about Larry Brown at the airport? He's driving an old...
I understand.
It's legal. Because we've talked about vehicles. That's all I'm saying.
I understand the concern. And normally I would say no. But this truck is of no good to any of us. If we auctioned it off, it would be a $200 value maybe.
Okay.
And by the way, Carlos Lastra is getting a new car very soon.
Okay, good.
How about,
what are we going to do with that one? Are you going to donate it to UTB too?
Okay. Charlie Cabler, excuse me.
This is an action item. Can we have a motion? I gotta travel tonight, guys.
Oh, okay.
I'm gonna approve.
Second.
Okay, motion by Commissioner Longoria, seconded by Commissioner Troiani. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Chief.
Yes, sir. Got one more item.
Okay.
Item 23, consideration and action to authorize payment of $45,237 for renewal of the train maintenance service agreement for the police department's air conditioning system for fiscal year 2007-2008.
This is the renewal of the maintenance agreement that we have with train for our chill water system. A chill water system that cost us over $1.34 million several years ago at the police department. This is the second year. This contract was approved 2 years ago with a condition that for the following 2 years it'll be approved on a yearly basis. This is the second year of that three-year contract.
Wow.
Would you approve?
Second.
Motion to approve by Commissioner Longoria, seconded by Commissioner Camarillo. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Item 24, consideration and action to authorize HNTB Amendment Number 28 for professional services to develop a pavement management program for the Brownsville South Padre Island International Airport.
Mayor, members of the City Commission, the City Commission is asked to consider an act to authorize an amendment to the contract with HNTB for the purpose of developing a computerized pavement management program for the Brownsville South Padre International Airport. The pavement management program will use micropaver computer software. This implements a policy that's being mandated by the FAA for airports to have computerized pavement management systems. The FAA is also funding this mandate. The cost is $154,125. It will result in a series of, for example, core samples to determine the existing condition of the pavement, all the way through analysis and placing and computerized software so we're able to predict in the future and also determine where we need to focus our funding in the future in terms of a five-year capital improvement program to be considered by the FAA. Staff recommends approval.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Atkinson, seconded by Commissioner Longoria. All in favor?
Commissioner Garza.
Aye. All opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Wait, what's
no,
it?
I'm sorry.
Motion to approve.
Aye.
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 Any motion against it? No? Okay. Motion carries unanimously. Next item, please.
Item 25, consideration and action to authorize change order number 1 for the taxiway G reconstruction, taxiway D lighting rehabilitation project at the Brownsville South Padre Island International Airport.
The City Mayor, members of the Commission, the City Commission is asked to consider an act on change order number 1 to the taxiway G project. This change order has been mandated by the FAA to implement its safety policy for the Brownsville Airport. The project cost is paid for in its entirety by the FAA. The project affects runway 1735 and creates a displaced threshold of 190 feet in order to bring the runway safety area in conformance with FAA policies. The total cost is $236,111. This will be a change to the existing contract for the contract to reconstruct taxiway G. The staff, as well as our engineers, recommend approval. I'll be happy to address any questions. I have an illustration here that shows you the displacement that needs to take place on the north end of 1735. That's the portion that's close to Boca Chica Boulevard.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Camarillo, seconded by Commissioner Atkinson. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Next item, please.
Item 26, consideration and action to authorize an offer of just compensation for the purchase of a 23.29-acre tract of land located on the southeast corner of South Illinois Avenue and California Road.
Members of the Commission, I am requesting your approval to make an offer of just compensation to purchase a 23.29-acre tract on the south side of California Road for its fair market value of $315,000. Again, this is FAA Part 150 money to be used to make the acquisition.
Motion to approve.
Second.
A motion is seconded by Commissioner Garza. Motion made by Commissioner Atkinson. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item 27, consideration and action to authorize a change to the Carter Burgess Contract Phase 2 Amendatory Agreement Number 1, Work Authorization 1D, Amendatory Agreement Number 2, and Contract Phase 3 for the Brownsville Urban Systems Multimodal Terminal Project.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. To give you a recap on the project, on March 16, 2004, the City Commission awarded a professional service agreement to the firm of Carter and Burgess for Phase 2 of the Multimodal Terminal Project. Phase 2 consists of preliminary planning and engineering services, environmental documentation, financial implementation plan, and appraisal services. The cost for the service of this phase of the project was $246,714, which was funded under a grant program of the Federal Transit Administration. To date, the scope of the work accomplished in Phase 2 is as follows. Task 1, project definition and programming, 100% complete, based on the funding that was available at the execution of the agreement. Task number 2, environmental assessment, 100% complete. Task number 3, site evaluation and conceptual development, 100% complete. Task number 4, preliminary planning schematic design, 100% complete.
This is what we talked about in executive session, right?
Yeah, move to approve.
You're within budget, right?
Right.
I move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Atkinson, seconded by Commissioner Danny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Motion adjourned.
Thank you.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.